Oh yeah! Not Ringo.
Happy New Year, everybody, from Dalek 44. Well, Christmas is over, Santa has come, and it's now 2016. And I'm still in a little bit of the post-Christmas blues. I mean, yeah, I did have fun playing with all my Christmas presents that I got, like the many DVDs I got, new clothes, chocolates and fruit pastels, Turkish delights, and the new LEGO Dimensions game for the Wii U. And you may be wondering, why I'm wearing these gloves and this hat? Well, it's still pretty cold over here in Bristol, and gotta keep warm somehow. But you know the one thing that keeps me really warm inside during this weather? A 2005 CG animated movie known as The Magic Roundabout. The Magic Roundabout, our friends together now. Come and take a trip, cause it's alright. Based on the TV series from the 1960s, The Magic Roundabout took all our favourite characters that we all knew from the 60s and put them on the big screen at last for this fully animated CGI movie. The idea for this movie was released long before the 2005 film was made. I can't exactly what year they announced it in the newspapers, but it was announced in the newspapers years before it was actually made. So how exactly does the film hold up compared to the original TV series and Dougal and the Blue Cat? Well, let's find out. Here's the story. During a concert made by Ermintrude, played by Joanna Lumley, Dougal, voiced by Robbie Williams, is looking for sugar from a sugar cart. While doing so, he accidentally breaks the magic roundabout, releasing an evil wizard named Zebad, voiced by Tom Baker, who intends to find three diamonds to freeze the sun completely. So Dougal and his friends Ermintrude, Brian and Dylan, and the train go off on an adventure to save the world from Zebad and find the three diamonds before he does. And the adventure takes them to many places, including snowy mountains, a volcano, jungles, and some old railway tracks, until they finally get back to their home to try and save the world from Zebad. So you've got a story that takes the characters away from the magic garden and takes them to save the whole world rather than their environment. So how exactly does it hold up? Well, I love it. I really love this film.
Making a movie based off of an old TV series would be no easy challenge. And God knows how many people have tried to do it and failed. But with The Magic Roundabout, I honestly think they succeeded. Not only did they capture the original spirit of The Magic Roundabout, in my opinion, but they captured it really well. The characters are still the characters that I knew from when I was watching the show, and the stuff they put in it is really entertaining. And the CGI in this movie is really impressive. Back when CGI was first made in the 90s, it wasn't very realistic compared to today. Looking at films like Toy Story, for example, the CGI was good back then, but today it's kinda dated. Well, okay, the toys and that one spoon looked alright, but the humans just looked more plastic than the toys. But during the 2000s, the CGI started to look more realistic, especially with Dougal. I mean, when you look at Dougal in this film, you can see every bit of hair on that damn dog. That's really impressive. And that duel between Zebedee and Zebad just kicked major ass. Even though it could have lasted a little bit longer, and personally I think it should, it was a really well done battle. The animation was great and the moves they did were great. Especially that moment where their springs stuck together at one point. So even though the battle could have been a little bit longer, it was awesome back then, and it's still awesome today. And the characters in the film are all the characters that we know from the TV series.
Now, I do miss Eric Thompson's voices for the characters, but I really think that they chose a good cast for these characters. I mean, some of them do sound like what I imagined they would sound like without Eric Thompson.
For instance, Dougal, voiced by Robbie Williams, is a sugar-loving dog who's a bit of a coward and a boaster, but in the end finds the courage to become a real hero.
Florence, voiced by Kylie Minogue, is a sweet little girl who's sort of like a Christopher Robin type character in this world. And she made the perfect role for the girl in peril and who everyone else had to save. Brian, voiced by Jim Broadbent, was a very optimistic kind of snail. And it's been shown in this film that he had a crush on Ermentrude. And I think I may have seen a little hint of it in one of the original shorts from the Magic Roundabout. But if I don't remember seeing it, then this is pretty new. And I honestly find that pretty interesting. Most films would try to force someone to be love interest, but this film doesn't really do it. Ermentrude, voiced by Joanna Lumley, is quite a vain cow who thinks of herself as a great sinner and is very posh and upper class, in her opinion. And you know when I said that people were forced to be the love interests in films? Well, here, Ermentrude wasn't forced to be the love interest. I mean, in this film, they made it interesting by having her completely clueless of Brian's feelings towards her. And this definitely wouldn't be the last time they did anything like this with love stories. But for the time, it was really creative and new. Dylan, voiced by Bill Nighy, is a sleepy rabbit who likes to fall asleep in every chance he gets. But he surprisingly helps out really well when they're in danger. And I found it really hilarious and kick-ass that he was able to show everybody his martial arts skills. The Train, voiced by British comedian Lee Evans, is an optimistic character, quite different from the show. But I honestly don't mind that. I think the optimistic personality goes really well with Lee Evans' voice. And even today I'm still not really sure why they got Lee Evans to voice the Train when it was clearly said in the show that the Train was a she. But I guess female trains can be voiced by any people. I mean, the female characters in Thomas the Tank Engine used to be all voiced by a guy. So in this world, anything's possible. And Lee Evans is really hilarious as the Train, especially with this line. Zebedee, voiced by Ian McKellen, is still the wise old Jack-in-the-Box toy we all know. But here we learn about his evil twin, Zebad, who's been imprisoned underneath the Magic Roundabout for years. And Zebedee's fear that he may return one day was finally realised in this film. And I think Ian McKellen's voice really goes well with Zebedee. I mean, it just personally suits the kind of character Zebedee is. And the only other character from the show that made it into this film was Mr. Rusby, voiced by Jimmy Hibbert. You know, the guy who voices pretty much every character in pretty much every UK children's TV show. But here he's just basically the same character that he is in the show, the guy who runs the roundabout and nothing else. And he was also there to be put in peril along with the other kids and as well as Florence. Now let's talk about the new characters. First there's Zebad, voiced by Tom Baker.
Free! At last! It took 10,000 years! But the best things are worth waiting for. Power, revenge, and more power!
Zebad is an evil wizard who's been imprisoned underneath the Magic Roundabout for 10,000 years and wants to bring the Ice Age back by finding three diamonds to freeze the sun. And I find it very interesting that as soon as he's free from the Magic Roundabout, things start to freeze over already. And I think his diabolical plan is so diabolical, even for this kid's film. Attempting to freeze the sun to turn the whole planet into a frozen wasteland. That's pretty dark, isn't it?
Soon it'll be nice and frozen everywhere, just like it was before Zebedee ruined everything.
This was the very first time I ever saw Tom Baker play a villain, because I normally see him playing likeable characters, like the drunk captain from Blackadder 2, the Doctor from Doctor Who, obviously, and the narrator from Little Britain. So it's quite rare that you see an actor like him play a villain. And he plays the part really, really well. I mean, his character is evil and knows it. He even took him being called the Despicable Fiend as being a compliment.
I know. It's a gift, really.
And I personally think Tom Baker as Zebad steals the movie. Whatever scene he's in, you could tell that he's just going all the way with it. I think it's pretty obvious that Tom Baker must have been having a freaking blast while voicing this character. Getting to do his loud, shouting, booming voice, as well as being really quiet and calm, but mostly insane.
The pressure! It's too much!
I know!
Sometimes I feel I'm going quite insane!
And I personally think that they should probably think about casting Tom Baker as a villain in other productions in the future. You wouldn't have thought that a guy like him who's played Doctor Who would be a very good villain, but in this film he surprised us all. and the character is just so full of pure evil. He's the kind of comedic villain that I really love, taking Finn seriously, but also just enjoying how evil he is. The character is evil and knows it and loves every minute of it.
Today, one soldier. Tomorrow, the world. And then perhaps, three more soldiers.
Focus, Dad. Focus.
And then there's his dim-witted henchman, Soldier Sam, voiced by Ray Winston. He was originally a dancing toy soldier on the Magic Roundabout who got blown off the Magic Roundabout when Z-Bad escaped. And as soon as Z-Bad discovered him, he used his magic to turn Sam into a henchman for himself. And throughout the film, Sam tries to be a really good soldier, but fails at most opportunities. He even fails at trying to do an evil laugh compared to Z-Bad's evil laugh.
No, Sam, it's all in the back of the throat.
And rather than just being a typical idiotic henchman, like on many other videos, Sam is bumbling, but he's also got a good heart. Even when he's given the job of torturing Dougal, he actually asks Dougal what he's afraid of. Now that's not very often you hear evil henchmen do that. This film tried its best to capture the spirit of the original shorts as Eric Thompson dubs them for the English audiences, and for the most part it succeeds. But if I have any problems with this film, it's in one minor area. It's the fact that Mr. McHenry and Buxton are absent from the film. And I'm assuming that this film takes place after the events of Dougal and the Blue Cat. I'm just assuming that. But for some reason, we never get to see Buxton or Mr. McHenry. And I honestly don't get why we don't see any of those two characters. Though Mr. McHenry may not have played a very big role in the film, but it still would have been nice to have seen him in the film. At least showing every single character that had been in the original Magic Roundabout TV series. But that's just one minor complaint, and it doesn't really come close to ruining this film, which is really good in my opinion. So I'd definitely say that the Magic Roundabout is a really good film. It's got great characters, a really good story, superb music, and great animation. The CGI is pretty good, and it does hold up even to this day, but I honestly miss the puppets. I mean, don't get me wrong, the CGI is good, and it does hold up to this day. It looks very realistic, including the hairs on Dougal. But every time I watch it, I do find myself thinking about the puppets a lot. Sometimes I wonder to myself what the movie would have been like if they'd made it with the puppets from the original show. Then again, if they did, it might have taken them a bit longer to have finished the film. Some people may not like the Magic Roundabout movie compared to the original TV series and Dougal and the Blue Cat, but for me personally, I love it. It was one of my favourite films from 2005. And every now and then I put it on the telly for some nostalgic feelings, since the characters are nostalgic to me. And I enjoy watching it to see how the animation is compared to the original puppets. And while the CGI animation is really superb, as I said before, I really do miss the puppets and wish that they were in here. But all that aside, The Magic Roundabout is a really great film, and I honestly enjoy going back to it every time I want to feel some nostalgia for that Magic Roundabout feeling. And if you haven't seen it yet, definitely check it out. It's a really great film with a really great story and really great characters, and you'll have a lot of fun watching Tom Baker as the villain. And for everyone out there who still has the post-Christmas blues, you'll get through it. And if you want some help getting through it, then put this movie on if you like it and get some nostalgic feelings if you ever grew up with the Magic Roundabout. I'm Donald 44, and happy 2016, everybody.
Not Ringo.
Hey guys, Dalek44 here. I need no introduction, but I got one anyway. Now, as you all may have guessed by now, I'm a big lover of nostalgia, as it's obviously been said in a few videos before. But that doesn't mean I have to tolerate some shit remakes and adaptations that people keep making.
And you may remember I did an editorial talking about remakes and adaptations and why there's so many shit ones compared to good ones. And long story short, some people do remakes of old things because they loved the originals, and some turn out good, some turn out okay, and some turn out as alright but could have been better. And then there's the ones that were obviously made because the people know that they're so popular and will just make a quick buck.
And alongside all these shit remakes and adaptations comes this masterpiece.
The latest Mickey Mouse cartoon is an American animated comedy television series produced by Disney Television Animation. It features classic cartoon characters including Mickey Mouse, Minnie Mouse, Donald Duck, Daisy Duck, Goofy, Pluto, Pete and other characters. The series has a slapstick feel of the classic Mickey Mouse shorts from the 30s while providing a modern update with the extensive use of Toon Boom, whatever the hell that is, and Flash animation. The show also places the title character, Mickey of course, in humorous situations that showcase his pluck and rascality, along with his long-beloved charm and good-heartedness.
And being a lover of Mickey Mouse, since I used to watch some of the old cartoons on VHS and Disney Channel, as well as House of Mouse and some other things Mickey Mouse has been in, like Christmas Carol, I thought I'd give this a check out. And to my surprise, it was hilarious.
And after watching the first few of these cartoons, I actually found myself laughing at them a lot. As I said, this show has the slapstick feel of the classic Mickey cartoons from the 30s, but it also has some references to modern things too. Like you see some modern day technology, and as I said, it has the modern Flash animation and Boomtoon, whatever the hell that is. But this is one of the few adaptations that I watch without thinking, it's so obvious that they made this thing because the character's so popular and will make money. I actually find myself watching this thinking that it's obvious the guys who made it loved Mickey Mouse. And what's not to love about him? It's obvious that if you have the right writer and right creative team, then you'll get a good remake and adaptation of something that was popular.
After watching many episodes of this cartoon, it's kind of obvious that the guys who made it obviously loved the original Mickey Mouse and wanted to put that much love and effort into this. And it really does show in every cartoon.
And some of you may have noticed that Mickey Mouse has gone through quite a few changes over the years. In the past, he was a rascal, and then he started to get a new personality over the years. The one I'm more familiar with is the smart aleck mouse that you see in Mickey Mouse Works in House of Mouse. And what I mean by that is, he often gets put into situations but uses smart and cunning to get out of the situation. Sort of like Bugs Bunny from the Looney Tunes. But I honestly think that makes sense since the two met in Who Framed Roger Rabbit. So it is possible that the Who Framed Roger Rabbit could have happened in the same timeline as Mickey Mouse cartoons did. Or at least that's what the writers wanted to do at the time. But I honestly think it fitted that version of Mickey really well. And Mickey's gone through a lot of adventures over the years, like the ones in the original shorts, his cameo in Who Framed Roger Rabbit, Mickey Mouse Works, House of Mouse, various movies, and some toddler shows that we'd like to forget. Now, I've got nothing against toddlers, but for me, Mickey Mouse was never a toddler character. He was a cartoon character like the Looney Tunes that was made for all ages. Well, Looney Tunes was actually made for adults at the time, but there were some cartoons out there like Mickey Mouse that were mostly made for all ages. So for me, Mickey Mouse is an all ages cartoon character. The show is created, written and directed by Paul Rudish, an American animator who originally worked with Cartoon Network Studios. Some of his most popular work includes Dexter's Laboratory, The Powerpuff Girls, Samurai Jack, Star Wars Clone Wars from 2003 to 2005, and My Little Pony Friendship is Magic, to name a few. The show takes the characters to various places, including their own environment, which I'm assuming is called Toontown, I'm not really sure, to various other countries like Paris, Venice, Tokyo, and New York. And in the ones that take place in different countries, they actually have the characters speak in the language that would be seen in those home countries. And I was very surprised and amazed that the original actors did the voices in those cartoons that were set in another country. I'm just sitting there watching those cartoons and thinking, wow, the actors must have had a lot of practice when doing those languages. And the voice actors they got for the show are really good choices for voice actors.
And if I'm completely honest, I wasn't too sure about the new voice actor they got for Mickey Mouse, Chris Damian. When I first heard about the new voice actor of Mickey Mouse, I just assumed that they were going to get the guy who voiced Mickey Mouse in the Epic Mickey games, since he sounded a little bit like Rain Allwright. But instead they got this other guy. At first I wasn't sure how the new voice actor for Mickey Mouse was going to be compared to Rain Allwright. But it turns out that he was really good. Hell, he was actually hilarious and made me laugh a number of times. I mean, every time I hear this version of Mickey Mouse with his new voice actor, I could tell that the actor just ran all the way with how crazy and wild Mickey is in this show. Like going over the top of it and just having a lot of fun with it. Russi Taylor, the original voice of Minnie Mouse, is back to voice as Minnie Mouse, which I'm quite honestly surprised. It quite surprises me that she's still voicing the character even though Wayne Allwright has passed away. And for those of you who don't know, they used to be husband and wife. But I'm honestly glad that she's still voicing the character. There's honestly just no other voice actress I'd rather have. Bill Farmer returns as Goofy and Pluto, and as always he does a great job with the two. Tony Anselmo returns as Donald Duck, and over the years I'm beginning to think that he's starting to sound like the voice actor, like not being able to understand Donald so much anymore. Which makes sense, since you never could understand everything that Donald said in the classic cartoons. Whereas when Tony first started voicing Donald, you could pretty much understand everything that he said. But here you find it a little bit harder to understand here. So I think that's quite a nice touch. Tress McNeill, the woman of a thousand voices, comes back to voice Daisy Duck. And she still does a great job of it, as every character she's ever voiced. We also got other actors like Gene Cummins as Pete, Alan Yun as Scrooge McDuck. Wow, Alan Yun is still voicing the guy. And Paul Rudish provides a few voice cameos as well in the show. The new Mickey Mouse show is definitely one of those new adaptations that's not complete shit, like many that I've talked about in the past. Some people would consider this just to be another Mickey Mouse show to make money, but most people really love this show, and who could blame them? It's well written, well animated, well acted, and it's obvious that the people who worked on this loved Mickey Mouse so much that they put all that love into these cartoons. And for those of you who find it hard to believe me, I'll give you my top 10 Mickey Mouse shorts to give you an idea of why this show is great. Yodelberg. On an old alpine yodeling mountain, Mickey must be quiet to yodel with Minnie, who lives at the top of the mountain. However, because the mountain is vulnerable to avalanches, if by anyone causing loud noises, Mickey must climb up there while avoiding hundreds of cuckoo clocks, bobsleds, an abominable snowman, a pig belching contest, and a bag of chips, before finally getting to the top of the mountain to meet Minnie. All the shit that Mickey's gotta go through just to get to the top to meet his girl is so hilarious and will have you on the floor every time, which makes it all the more satisfying when he finally does get to the top. Bad Ear Day. Mickey spends the whole cartoon searching for his ears after losing them before a date with Minnie. It's so hilarious to see Mickey losing his ears for the first time, and I'm assuming this is the first time Mickey lost his ears because I never saw him lose his ears in any of the previous cartoons. But it's just a hilarious cartoon to see him going around the city trying to find his ears before he misses his date with Minnie. And because Mickey can't hear anything because of the loss of his ears, we can't hear anything that goes around him too. So we're basically hearing things as Mickey hears them, which is a really nice touch if you ask me. New York Queen. While taking a walk down Central Park, New York, Mickey buys Minnie a hot dog with extra mustard. But the hot dog has a mind of its own and runs away, which causes Mickey to go chase it throughout the city. It's just hilarious to see a hot dog come into life in a Mickey Mouse cartoon after all these years. And the stuff that Mickey's got to go through to try and catch this hot dog is just so freaking hilarious. And I can't get enough of those sweet moments between Mickey and Minnie because I'm a lover of their love story. Goofy's First Love. Mickey and Donald try to help a hapless Goofy woo the love of his life. This is basically another one of those stories where someone falls in love and his friends are trying to get him to get the girl the way he may think is the way to get the girl. Like looking beautiful, being rich, and all that stuff. But what really makes this episode stand out to me is the fact that Scrooge McDuck returns, voiced by Alan Young. It was really a great return for Scrooge McDuck, who's one of my favourite Disney characters. Even though it was a really short appearance, it was a great return for him. And this cartoon will just have you laughing all the way through. A Flower for Minnie. Mickey sets out to find the perfect flower for Minnie. This cartoon is just one of the sweetest cartoons I've ever seen in the new Mickey Mouse cartoon. Just the lengths that Mickey is willing to go through to find one minuscule flower for his girlfriend. It's really hilarious, and the ending is really sweet too. Wish upon a coin. When Pete steals all the coins from a wishing well, it's up to Mickey to stop him. This is the first time in a while I've seen Mickey go up against Pete since the House of Mouse cartoons. And it's just hilarious to see Pete stealing all the coins and Mickey having to stop him. And I thought it was really interesting to see cameos from the Seven Dwarfs and Snow White. As well as that Snow White-like ending at the end of the cartoon. I won't really give too much away, but trust me when I say it's hilarious. EUD Minnie. Minnie tries on a new perfume called Entrancement while getting ready for a date with Mickey. This cartoon is just so hilarious because that perfume just entrances everyone into liking Minnie. The people, the cars, the buildings, even the bloody sun. And it also takes a pretty heavy hit at Mickey Mouse Clubhouse as it points out the fact that the dress she wore in Clubhouse made her look too young. It's just hilarious to see what shit Minnie goes through while wearing that perfume, and the ending is so hilarious that you'll be laughing on the floor. Doggone biscuits. Mickey goes away for a month and needs Minnie to take care of Pluto. But Pluto starts to gain weight after Minnie keeps feeding him too many dog treats. I think this cartoon is Minnie at her looniest. She points out that she knows that she shouldn't feed Pluto too many treats, but she can't help herself. And the way she says she can't help herself is just so hilarious to me. And the stuff she goes through to try and get Pluto to lose weight is really hilarious. Despite the fact that I think it's kind of creepy to see a photograph of a fat Minnie Mouse. But nevertheless, this is a hilarious cartoon, and it always makes me laugh every time. No. When people keep asking to borrow things from Mickey, he realizes that he has trouble saying no, and turns to Donald for help. The only problem with that is that the help was so good that Mickey can't help saying no all the time. This was the most recent one I've seen, but I think it deserved the number 2 spot. Because I just find it hilarious how many people take advantage of him not being able to say no, like Minnie, Goofy, Scrooge McDuck, Mortimer Mouse, Huey, Dewey and Louie, Pete, a dog catcher, and the 3 little pigs. But like all Mickey Mouse cartoons, he does get a happy ending at the end, which is really satisfying after he goes through all the shit he goes through. And my absolute favourite for the new show is Wonders of the Deep. Mickey and Donald have to rescue Professor Von Drake when a freak accident sends him into the sea. But they have to beware of the Kraken. It's nice to see Professor Von Drake in this cartoon, and it's nice to see this episode lengthened into 7 minutes compared to the other 3-minute shorts. And 7 minutes was really fitting for this cartoon because there was so much going on. Like seeing sunken ruins, hallucinating mermaids that turn out to be good resemblances of Minnie and Daisy, before coming face to face with the legendary Kraken. And we also get a hilarious cameo from Pinocchio in this cartoon. But my absolute favourite moment from this cartoon is when they hallucinate mermaids that look exactly like their girlfriends. It's a really sweet and adorable moment, and it just proves that Minnie and Daisy are the only girls for Mickey and Donald. But what the hell do I know? Check the show out for yourselves and see what you've been missing, or probably glad you've been missing, however you feel about Mickey Mouse. But I guarantee that if you loved Mickey Mouse, then you're definitely going to love this show. It's well written, well acted, well animated, and the jokes are so hilarious that you'll be laughing on the floor for ages. I'm Dalek44, and I'll see you next time, folks.
Not Ringo.
Guys, Dalek44 here. I need no introduction, but I got one anyway. And welcome to my third installment of The Villain Files. few people can be said to have changed the course of history. But how many people have ensured the safety of their own race until the very end of time itself? Created life itself? Have been responsible for the death of millions? Tonight's villain has done that, and more. This is Davros, creator of the Daleks. The story of Davros starts not in 1975 when we first met him in Genesis of the Daleks, but it starts really in 2006 when his childhood was revealed in the audio drama, I, Davros. Davros was born during the Thousand Year War between his people, the Khaleds, and the Fowls. Even at a young age, Davros himself wanted to be a scientist, but his father and everybody else around him wanted him to be a soldier, like his father and all their fathers before them. Only Davros' mother encouraged him to follow his passion and become a scientist and help win the war. As soon as he was old enough, Davros joined the Khaled army and was ordered to build weapons that would help them win the war. Even though he saw it as a waste of his time, he progressed with it anyway to show that he was cleverer than all the idiots. And one battle where he'd also be joined with his right-hand man, Nida, left Davros heavily wounded, deformed, lost one of his hands, and the use of his legs. But he managed to survive his injuries and build himself a life support system and an artificial visual sensor. When Davros realized that the weapons used in the war were causing his people, the Khaleds, to mutate, he tried to find a way to make his people survive to the bitter end, by placing these mutants in a metal tank, creating the ultimate killing machine. And he called these creatures the Daleks. But Davros also made some changes to their genetic structure. He removed all their weaker emotions, like the feeling of pity, meaning that they'd hate everything that isn't Dalek. The Fourth Doctor first encountered the evil scientist when he and his companions were sent to Skara to avert the creation of the Daleks. Davros had only just created his first army of Daleks when the Doctor arrived. After an interrogation with the Doctor, Davros learns that the Daleks would survive onto the future, but fail in some of their missions. Very keen to know which missions the Daleks failed in, Davros forced the Doctor to tell him every defeat from the Daleks so that he would program his creations so that they would know their errors and how to avoid them. Even though the Doctor told him that the Daleks were totally evil, Davros refused to accept it since they were created to survive, and the only way they could survive was by becoming the dominant species in the universe. So Davros saw them as the power of good, since they would end all wars. But after the Doctor questioned him about creating a virus that would destroy other forms of life and whether he would deny their use or not, Davros soon realized that with his Daleks he could control the universe, and so made a quick decision to say that he would do it, as he believed that the power would send him up above the gods. But very suddenly, the Daleks turned on their creator, following the orders which he gave them, killing all the Khaled scientists, as well as their creator, Davros. Man, he should have seen that coming. In his first appearance, Genesis of the Daleks, Davros was portrayed by the late Michael Wisher, who had previously voiced the Daleks episodes before this. And he brought so much intelligence to Davros from years to come, and for everybody who had followed on from him, brought in a cool, crisp, Nazi, fundamental intelligence to the character, which would later be carried on by the many other actors who will portray the character. Sure, it seemed like Davros was gone for good now after his Daleks exterminated him, but he wasn't going to lie around dead for long. Sit around dead, since he's sitting in a chair and can't really lie down. But you get the point. Centuries later, it was revealed that Davros was not killed by the Daleks, but they just damaged his primary life support systems. And he was placed in suspended animation while his secondary backup circuits repaired him. And it was at the same time where the Daleks were at war with another robotic race known as the Mavellans. They found Davros as they needed him to help them find a way to win the war against the Mavellans, since the two were in a stalemate. Davros came up with a plan to blow up the Mavellan ship before it lifts off so that his Daleks would win the war. But once again, the Daleks' creator was defeated by the Doctor and imprisoned in a suspended animation chamber before being taken back to Earth to face trial for his crimes against the universe. In the second appearance, Destiny of the Daleks, Michael Wisher was unable to portray the character again due to his acting commitments, so he was replaced by an actor called David Goodison, who followed on as Davros. Still as mad as ever, even though he had to work in Michael Wisher's mask, which was obviously too small for him, David Goodison brought so much intelligence to the character that Michael Wishaw had before him, and still as mad as ever. Many years later, Davros was released from his space station prison by a small Dalek force aided by humans. The Daleks required Davros to help them find an antidote from a villain-created virus that has all but wiped them out. Believing his creations to be treacherous, Davros lied to the Daleks and instead conducted experiments on them to make him obey them. But as soon as the Supreme Dalek found out Davros' secret plans, he sent some Daleks to exterminate him. So Davros had to unleash the virus on his Daleks, killing all the Daleks on the ship. But the virus started to affect Davros too, and he had to escape. Years later, the Sith Doctor discovered that Davros had survived the Mavenum virus as he had an escape pod which took him to a planet called Necros. During his time on Necros, he was known as the Great Healer, since he had conquered many diseases that brought many victims to him. But none of his victims expected to come back as Daleks. While the high intelligent humanoids became Daleks, the lesser intelligence became food. But Davros didn't bother to tell anyone that they might be to their own relatives, since he believes that that would have created what he thinks is termed consumer resistance. During his encounter with the Sith Doctor, Davros had his hand blown off by a laser held by Orseel, and eventually his original Daleks captured him and took him back to Skaro to face trial. Davros somehow managed to escape his creations and created his own army of Daleks, which he called Imperial Daleks. Davros travelled to Earth in the 1960s to find a Time Lord artifact called the Hand of Omega, as he planned to use it to turn his own planet's sun into a source of unimaginable power, so that he and the Daleks could destroy Gallifrey and become the Lords of Time. It was unlucky for Davros that the Renegade Daleks, as he called them, led by the Supreme Dalek, were also after the Hand of Omega, which led to a civil war between the Renegade Daleks and the Imperial Daleks. The Imperial Daleks, however, had the upper hand against the Renegade Daleks, as Davros managed to obtain the Hand of Omega, but the Seventh Doctor tricked Davros into destroying his own planet, and the Mothership as well. But thankfully, Davros managed to escape in an escape pod just before the ship was destroyed. During the 1980s, Davros was portrayed by an actor called Terry Molloy, who brought so much intelligence to Davros that the previous actors had had before him, and he'd even introduced Davros' insane laugh, which would follow on with Davros for years to come. Many people consider Terry Molloy to be the best classic Davros, and who could blame them? He just brings so much energy and insanity to the character. He's especially brilliant when working with Peter Davison, Colin Baker and Sylvester McCoy. And he's even appeared at many Doctor Who conventions, including the 50th anniversary convention which I attended. Hell, I even got the guy to sign my Davros collection box set. After coming very close to death countless times, Davros has always found a way to survive and escape. And he'd be sure to survive until his Daleks became the rulers of the universe. And he managed to survive into the Time War. Davros continued to survive into the Time War, where his command ship flew into the jaws of the Nightmare Chart. The Eighth Doctor attempted to save him, but from both perspectives, Davros was killed during the first year of the war. Years later, Dalek Khan, the last member of the Cult of Skaro, used Emergency Temporal Shift to travel back into the Time War and save Davros, at the cost of his sanity. Davros then started extracting cells from his own body to create a new army of Daleks, which must have put a considerable amount of strain and pain on his body. And once again, Davros managed to survive that. He then created a space station for the Daleks known as the Crucible, where he started stealing 27 planets to power up his new invention known as the Reality Bomb, a space cannon that could destroy all of reality. Davros and the Daleks started stealing several planets, including Earth, Klon, the lost moon of Poosh, Pyrovilia, and the Adipose Breeding World, to name a few, as they could be used to power up his reality bomb so that he could destroy all of reality and make the Daleks the only life forms in existence. But Davros wasn't in charge of the Daleks, as that role belonged to the Supreme Dalek. So while the Supreme Dalek commanded the Daleks, Davros was left away in the vault with Dalek Khan, who at that time had gone insane. By the time the Doctor found all the planets, as well as the Crucible at the Medusa Cascade, Davros had captured him and all his companions that he'd travelled with and brought them to the Crucible so that they could watch all of reality being destroyed. After Davros had captured all the companions, including Donna Noble, He used his electric power from his newly built robotic hand to electrocute Donna, which opened up the Doctor living inside of her after the meta crisis when he touched the Doctor's spare hand, which was full of regeneration energy. And she used her Time Lord knowledge to shut down the reality bomb and make all the Daleks lose control of themselves. At this time, Davros learned too late that Dalek Khan came to realize what the Daleks had done throughout time and space, used his prophecies and influence to ensure the Daleks' destruction once and for all. The human clone of the Doctor used this prophecy to destroy the Crucible as well as the Dalek fleet. Even though the 10th Doctor attempted to save his archenemy, Davros furiously refuses the Doctor's help and accuses him of being responsible for the destruction, while proclaiming him to be the destroyer of worlds. And for a while, that would be the last time we ever saw Davros.
After the Dalek Crucible blew up in the Battle of the Medusa Cascade in 2009, it seemed like Davros was gone for good. But we all got a surprise when he returned last year.
Nobody quite knows how Davros survived the destruction of the Crucible. Some say it was an emergency escape pod, though that seems too obvious. I personally think that he used emergency temporal shift. Because since he's the creator and experimenter of the Daleks, it is possible that he would have an emergency temporal shift like the Cult of Scarlet. Eventually, the Daleks found Davros, or vice versa, and rebuilt the planet Skaro, where Davros started experimenting on the Daleks for his own benefits. Apparently, Davros was dying of old age, and at that point he remembered seeing the 12th Doctor when he was a child. It was revealed that Davros was surrounded by handmines on the planet Skaro during the war with the Fowls, and the Doctor intended to save Davros before learning his name. After remembering that the Doctor left him to die, Davros seeks the final revenge on the Time Lord, and employs Colony Sarf to bring him to Skaro. When the Doctor is brought to Skaro, Davros forces him to watch the Daleks kill Missy and Clara Oswald. In anger and fury, the Doctor forces Davros out of his life support chair and steals it to control the Daleks. But unfortunately for the Doctor, Colony Sarf's agents, which were dozens of snakes, hid inside Davros' chair and brought the Doctor and the chair back to the infirmary where Davros was waiting. After a long discussion, Davros learns that the Doctor saved Gallifrey during the Time War. Feeling surprisingly happy for the Doctor, he opens his eyes for the first time in years to see the Doctor one last time with his own eyes. And feeling like it's his final moment, Davros asks the Doctor if he was a good man and if he was right to create the Daleks. The two eventually put their differences aside and watch the sun rise together. But as it seems that Davros is about to die before the sun can rise, the Doctor gives him a little bit of his regeneration energy to heal him, only to discover that Davros was actually tricking the Doctor into giving him his regeneration energy so that Davros could feed it into himself and his Dalek army. This was part of Davros' plan to fulfill a prophecy on Gallifrey which spoke of a hybrid, as Davros believed that the hybrid was part Dalek, part Time Lord. Davros succeeded in having regeneration energy being put into every single Dalek. But what Davros didn't realise was that the Doctor also put some of his regeneration energy into the dying Daleks that were left to rot in the sewers of Skaro. And as soon as they were revived, they rose up to the city and attacked all the other Daleks. The Doctor and Clara managed to escape Skaro, leaving Davros, the Daleks and Missy to die. Though it is more than likely that Davros somehow survived this near-death experience. Since if there's one thing he knows how to do, it's survive. So you can bet that he'll be back to bring hell to the Doctor's life once again. During the new series, Davros was portrayed by actor Julian Bleach, who brought back all the intelligence to Davros that the previous actors had done before him. He even introduced Davros to a new kind of insane laugh compared to Terry Molloy's laugh, and I'm really hoping that Julian Bleach plays Davros throughout the new series, because at the moment there's no other actor I'd rather have as Davros. To me, Julian Bleach is the best Davros around. As well as the TV series, Davros has also made appearances in comic strips, audio plays including I, Davros, as I mentioned earlier, novels, and he's even appeared in a theatre production called The Trial of Davros. In 1993, he was portrayed by the original actor Michael Wisher. Then when it was redone in 2005, he was portrayed by Terry Molloy. In 2008, Julian Bleach appears live as Davros at the Doctor Who prom, announcing that the Royal Albert Hall would become his new palace, and the audience his obedient slaves. Davros also appeared in the new LEGO Dimensions game in the Doctor Who level pack, entitled The Daleks in Extermination of Earth, where he was once again portrayed by Julian Bleach. Davros is one of the most interesting villains that I've seen in my time. He's very intelligent, he believes that he's a good man even though he's gone completely insane, he created the Doctor's worst enemies of all time, and his intelligence is somewhat equal to the Doctor's. Davros has become one of my all-time favourite villains since I was first introduced to him in Genesis of the Daleks. Not just because he created the Daleks, but I think that he makes the perfect enemy for the Doctor. Both their intelligences are somewhat equal, and even though they're mortal enemies, they do give a level of respect to each other. And as well as talking as enemies, Davros likes to talk to the Doctor as men of science, since their intelligences are somewhat equal, and they could exchange ideas to each other. Davros is just one of those villains who doesn't see himself as an evil guy or a ruthless dictator. He just sees himself as a guy who wants to see the survival of his own race. And the only way he could see doing that was by putting him inside a tank. And all those things is what makes Davros one of the greatest villains of all time. And that's the lowdown on Davros for the third Villain Files installment. Keep checking out my channel for more Villain Files very soon. I'm Dialer44, and I'll see you next time, folks. I love this Sonic Screwdriver.
Not Ringo.
Hey guys, Dialer44 here. I need no introduction, but I've got one anyway. And as it's Valentine's Day, I thought we'd spend the day to take a look at one of my favourite Mickey and Minnie Mouse cartoons, who happen to be one of my favourite animated couples of all time. As I've mentioned before in my top 10 love stories list, Mickey and Minnie Mouse are one of my favourite love stories of all time. I loved them growing up, and I still love them today. I just find them to be one of the most entertaining love stories I've ever seen in media. And what better way to prove their love for each other than by looking at that wonderful cartoon from the late 90s, Around the World in 80 Days. Around the World in 80 Days is an animated short originally featured in episode 6 of Mickey Mouse Works, and was later featured in the House of Mouse episode Mickey and Minnie's Big Vacation, which was how I was introduced to it. So we got a Mickey Mouse cartoon that's a 2-part to 7-minute cartoon. It's based off of an old novel. So how exactly can 2-part to short cartoons based on this big novel work? Well, let's take a look.
Based on Jules Verne's classic novel, in this adaptation Mickey Mouse must travel around the world in 80 days in order to retrieve an inheritance to save an orphanage that he runs. And along the way he comes across many different things in different countries, as well as meeting the love of his life, Princess Minnie Mouse. And that's basically the whole story. Oh yeah, and Scrooge McDuck's the villain in this too. Even though I never really read the original novel, or watched anything based on the novel, well, except for that one Looney Tunes movie where they had Tweety Pie going around the world in 80 days, and that's pretty much it. I really do enjoy this cartoon. Even though it's compiled of 2 7-minute shorts, it really does do the story really well. Sort of like how they managed to fit the Christmas Carol story into 1 20-minute cartoon when Mickey Mouse adapted for it.
When I first watched this short on House of Mouse, I enjoyed it a lot. But looking at it again today, I still enjoy it. In fact, I consider it one of the best Mickey Mouse cartoons I've ever seen from the 90s and early 2000s.
And the characters in the short are pretty much the same characters that we all know and love.
Mickey Mouse plays the lead role in it, who runs an orphanage that has shitloads of bills and he needs to get some money to, you know, save the orphanage. And once he has the news of this inheritance, then he's willing to go around the world in 80 days like Scrooge McDuck told him in order to get it, because he was just willing to save the orphanage. This was just a really nice version of Mickey, just like going through any lanes just to get enough money to save the orphanage that he runs. And on his journeys, he's joined by Goofy, who pretty much plays the comic relief of the film. And just being, well, Goofy.
Well, obviously.
And then there's Minnie Mouse, who plays the princess of a Bombay village that they come across while riding an elephant. And I personally think that the outfit they gave Minnie in this cartoon is one of the cutest outfits I've ever seen her in. We've all known that Minnie has gone through quite a fashion change over the years, and going through many different outfits in different cartoons. But I find this one to be one of the cutest she's ever worn. And it's another one of those scenarios where Mickey falls in love with Minnie and Minnie falls in love with Mickey.
Well, obviously.
But then again, what do you expect for a cartoon that features Mickey and Minnie Mouse, eh?
It's another one of those cartoons where it just proves that Mickey and Minnie are meant for each other. The scene that definitely proves it is near the end of the cartoon when Mickey gives Minnie all the money he has for dancing shows and all that stuff.
I love you, not money.
Gosh, really?
You bet.
Oh, you guys are just swell.
That was just another one of those sweet moments to me.
And Scrooge McDuck returns to play the villain in this cartoon.
The first time I watched this short on an episode of House of Mouse, I was really surprised to see Scrooge McDuck in it for a long time since DuckTales, and the fact that he was still voiced by Alan Young. And he really was the perfect villain for this cartoon.
This cartoon was the first time I've ever seen Scrooge McDuck in a role besides DuckTales, and I really enjoyed him in this film. He's basically the same old cat that we knew him from DuckTales.
Well, obviously.
But in this cartoon, his greediness and love of money was pushed up to the same type of level that was when he was in A Christmas Carol. And I'm really glad that Alan Young returned to voice the character, because there's just no other act I'd rather have as Scrooge McDuck. Alan Young just plays the part really well.
Well, obviously.
And we also have an unnamed Pelican, who's one of the people in his office, and an unnamed Goose, voiced by the late Tony J.
We've got to have money.
And just like in some of previous cartoons that appeared in Mickey Mouse Works and House of Mouse, such as The Nutcracker and Mickey's Mechanical House, to name a few, famous Monty Python and Fawlty Towers actor John Cleese comes in as the narrator for this short. You may remember how when I reviewed Mickey's Magical Christmas Snowden at the House of Mouse and how I loved John Cleese's narration in The Nutcracker, well, in this cartoon, he's not really around as much as he was in The Nutcracker. But I honestly don't mind that. I just find it such a pleasure to hear his voice in a cartoon. And like in The Nutcracker, he does get to break the fourth wall at least once.
Over a century ago, before airplanes filled the air, I said before they filled the air, thank you.
I fucking love that scene. And I find the animation in this cartoon to be really nicely animated too. Of course, it doesn't have any of the shadings and lightings and high-quality stuff that other Mickey Mouse films like Prince and the Pauper and Mickey's Once Upon a Christmas had. But it's still really decent animation, and I really enjoy watching this cartoon every now and then. Now, if I did have any problems with this cartoon, it is the length. And don't get me wrong, I still enjoy it. But I just think that it could also work as a full-length feature film. I mean, like The Prince and the Pauper, The Three Musketeers, and Mickey's Christmas Carol, and others. So I sometimes wonder what it would have been like if this cartoon was a full-length feature film. But the length it's in now is really enjoyable, and I still enjoy it even to this day. And you may remember that a few years ago, I did a TTT summer special based on this cartoon.
Well, obviously.
Shut up!
I mainly did it because I really loved this cartoon, and I really wanted to do a special like that. And it was an idea that I've had in my head for a while. I love the cartoon that much.
If you're a lover of Mickey and Minnie Mouse cartoons, then I'd definitely check this one out. It's one of those cartoons that shows that Mickey and Minnie are meant for each other. And it's one of the most entertaining ones I've seen in the early 2000s.
So in my opinion, Mickey's Around the World in 80 Days is definitely one of the best Mickey Mouse cartoons I've ever seen in a lifetime. So if you're in the mood for Mickey Mouse fun and romance between Mickey and Minnie, then I'd definitely recommend this cartoon. It's got a lot of laughs, a lot of goofiness from Goofy, and you'll really enjoy Scrooge McDuck as the villain, and the Mickey and Minnie moments are really sweet, as always.
So I hope you all have a really good Valentine's Day, and until next time, this is Starlet44 saying cheerio.
Oh yeah!
Not Ringo!
Hey guys, Dunk44 here. I need no introduction, but I've got one anyway. Do you know what I love? Comedy films. Do you know what else I love? Nick Frost and Simon Pegg. But do you know what I really, really love? Simon Pegg and Nick Frost being in that wonderful comedy film, Hot Fuzz.
Hot Fuzz is a 2007 satirical action comedy film directed by Edgar Wright, written by Wright and Simon Pegg, and starring Pegg and Nick Frost. It was the second film in the Three Flavors Cornetto trilogy.
What the fuck is he on about? What the fuck are you on about?
And for those of you who are wondering why they call it the Three Flavors Cornetto trilogy, it's because there's a Cornetto ice cream in each film.
Oh, yes! Of course!
After the successful DVD sales for Shaun of the Dead, they decided to make a sequel, but this time focusing on police officers.
It's already been proven in Shaun of the Dead that Edgar Wright, Simon Pegg and Nick Frost had their work cut out for them. But could they really make a cop film after Shaun of the Dead? Well, let's take a look.
Police Constable Nicholas Angel, played by Simon Pegg, is a high-achieving police officer in the Metropolitan Police Service of London. He gets promoted to sergeant, but it comes with being transferred to the village of Sanford in Gloucestershire. And why do they transfer him to the country?
The fact is, you've been making us all look bad.
That is a hilariously unprofessional reason for transferring someone to the country. When Angel arrives in Sanford, he finds that it's generally devoid of any crime, with its local neighbourhood watch alliance helping to keep the peace as everyone prepares for the Village of the Year award contest. Angel finds a minimum amount of crime there during his time, such as chasing a swan, chasing after someone stealing from the local shop, but his biggest crime so far was finding a shed that's full of unlicensed firearms, including a sea mine. He does a majority of his jobs with his new partner, PC Danny Butterman, played by Nick Frost, the son of Chief Inspector Frank Butterman, played by Jim Broadbent. Now, of course, being a high-quality police officer, Angel isn't too happy that the village is so tranquil compared to London. But before long, the town suddenly is struck by a series of violent deaths. Nicholas begins to suspect that these are part of a conspiracy, although Danny seems to be more concerned with discussing his love of action and buddy cop films. Furthermore, the rest of the police force refuse to believe the deaths are deliberate and pass them off as accidents. Angel's prime suspect for the crimes is local supermarket owner Simon Skinner, played by Timothy Dalton. But as Angel digs deeper and deeper into the murders, he finds that the crime is much bigger than he expected, which leads to car chases, gunfights, and a climax that's so big that it takes up most of the film.
So what's my opinion of Hot Fuzz? It's the best film in the Three Flavors Cornetto trilogy.
Out of all the films in the Three Flavors Cornetto trilogy, Hot Fuzz is my ultimate favourite. One of the reasons is because I'm not a huge fan of zombie films or anything that's very gory. But with Shaun of the Dead, I did make an exception because it is hilarious and has a lot of funny moments in it. But I just love Hot Fuzz a bit more because it's focusing on cops and crimes. I guess my love of cops and crimes comes from the episode of The Simpsons titled Who Shot Mr. Burns? Yeah, that's probably it. But the film also has this great mystery that builds up to the great payoff at the end.
Now, just a little warning here, guys. There's a major spoiler ahead for like the two of you who haven't seen this movie.
By the end of the film, we learn that the murders were committed by the members of the Neighbourhood Watch Alliance of Sanford, led by Frank Butterman. Yeah, big shot there. Frank Butterman, played by Jim Broadbent, is the villain of this film.
You're not seriously going to believe this man, are you? Are you? He isn't even from around here!
This was the second time I ever saw Jim Broadbent play a villain. The first time was in the CGI movie Robots. But this was also the first time I've seen Jim Broadbent play a murderous character. Of course, he starts off in the film as being an innocent, likeable character that we know him to play as. But by the end of the film, we learn his true intentions and how psychotic he is. This was really a huge surprise for me when I first watched this film, because I never expected Jim Broadbent's character to be the main villain. From watching the trailers, I always assumed that Timothy Dalton's character, Simon Skinner, would be the villain, since the trailers made it out that Timothy Dalton's character was the villain. But it just turned out that there was more than one villain, and Jim Broadbent played the major villain. That was a pretty amazing surprise for me the first time I ever watched this movie. In any other film, they could have made Jim Broadbent just a straight-up bad guy. But because of the backstory, you kind of feel sorry for him. He was doing all this just because he lost his wife when they lost the title for Village of the Year. That's quite a tragic backstory for the villain. But it's not enough to make you sympathize with him that much because of everything he's done. In fact, Danny put it best.
If she could see what you've become, I think she'd probably kill herself all over again.
And this film has so many celebrities, so I could just go on pointing out every single one of them. But there isn't enough time, so I'll just go through a few of them.
Sergeant Nicholas Angel, played by Simon Pegg, is a workaholic who was transferred to the country from London for being too exceptional. Nick's not a bad person and doesn't really miss things outside of his job deliberately. He just wants to be really good at what he does. The only problem is that he's a workaholic. Even Danny helps him to realise that he needs to shut off every once in a while. And PC Danny Butterman, played by Nick Frost, is the exact opposite of Nick Frost's character in Shaun of the Dead. Whereas in Shaun of the Dead, Nick's character had no ambitions whatsoever. Danny had a lot of ambitions to be a good police officer. And he wants to see a lot of gory action like you see in cop films. And the list of other characters is so huge that it would take me forever to go through them all. There's Timothy Dalton as Simon Skinner, Paul Freeman from Mighty Morphin Power Rangers the movie as Reverend Shooter. Yeah, that's right, Ivan Ooze from Mighty Morphin Power Rangers plays a reverend.
Oh, fuck off, grasshopper.
I fucking love that line coming out of a vicar.
Martin Freeman as the Metropolitan Sergeant, Steve Coogan as the Metropolitan Inspector, Bill Nighy as the Chief Inspector of the Metropolitan, David Bradley as the farmer who owned a shitload of unlicensed guns as well as a sea mine, Peter Jackson as the guy dressed as Santa Claus in the beginning.
What?
That's right, that Peter Jackson. The guy who directed The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit trilogy.
Oh, that's good. That's very good indeed.
A majority of the movie was shot in Wales in Somerset, which is very well known for me because I used to visit that place a lot when I was little. And when I found out that they filmed that movie in Wales, I was really surprised. I could literally just say to everyone, I've been to the village where they filmed Hot Fuzz. This movie has a lot to offer for everybody who's a fan of cop films and comedies. Various cameos from celebrities, amazing effects that were used to create explosions, gore and gunfire scenes.
Now, I'm not usually a huge fan of gory things in movies and TV series. But for Hot Fuzz, I can tolerate it, because it's got so many funny things in it that I can't stop watching it. And it has one of the best climaxes ever.
The most gore I'm used to seeing is stuff that comes from Family Guy and American Dad in South Park. But for Hot Fuzz, I can tolerate it, because it's just so bloody hilarious. Especially in this scene where Nicholas Angel has to pretend he's Michael talking to Timothy Dalton.
Michael, is everything okay?
Yarp.
Sergeant Angel's been taken care of.
Yarp.
He's not gonna get back up again.
Narp.
Good.
The movie also has a lot of references to the other films in the Cornetto trilogy. Like a jukebox that appears in every single film. Various actors who appeared in all the films. And my ultimate favourite, the fence joke. The fence joke just gets me every time in these films. But my favourite fence joke obviously comes from Hot Fuzz. So I just find it really hilarious to see that Simon Pegg's character did it really well, and Nick Frost's character just ran right through the first fence. That still cracks me the fuck up.
So in my opinion, Hot Fuzz is the best film in the Three Flavors Cornetto trilogy, and it continues to be my favourite in the trilogy to this day.
But if you have a different favourite film in the Three Flavors Cornetto trilogy, then I'd like to hear what they are. But for me, Hot Fuzz would be my ultimate favourite Three Flavors Cornetto film. If you haven't seen Hot Fuzz yet, then I'd definitely check it out. It's all for the greater good.
I'm Dino 44, and I'll see you next time, folks. God, that movie's hilarious.
not Ringo.
Hey guys, Starlet44 here. I need no introduction, but I've got one anyway. Now this new top 10 list is going to be about something I may have talked about a few times in the past.
It's the Lego Movie, isn't it?
So what if it is?
I know I may have talked about the Lego Movie loads of times in the past, but I just can't help it. It's just honestly one of the best animated movies I've ever seen in my lifetime. With its superb animation, clever writing, imaginative ideas, great directing, and superb voice acting, then we got a movie that people were shocked didn't win an Academy Award last year. Yeah, it's true, the Lego Movie wasn't nominated for an Oscar last year, which pissed off a lot of people. There's just so many things in this movie to point out why it's awesome, and we're going to look at some of them today.
So, without wasting any time, I'm going to show you the top 10 reasons why I really love the Lego Movie. So, sit back, relax, get out your bag of Haribo, and enjoy my top 10 reasons why I think the Lego Movie is awesome.
Number 10. The animation. This is one of those rare films where I watch a CGI film and honestly believe that I'm in a real world. Well, real Lego world, but you get what I mean. Compare the animation in the Lego Movie to a movie like, say, the first Toy Story film. Yeah, it is still a great animated film and it has a well-written story and great acting and memorable characters. But when you look at the animation today, it's not as great as you remember it to be compared to the Lego Movie's animation. Now with the toys and the spoon that they had in one scene, they do look like real toys. But there's just some bits in the film like the humans and some of the backgrounds that just seem obvious that they're CGI. With the Lego Movie, they upped the animation to top-notch levels.
The first time I watched this movie, I really did believe that I was watching a stop-motion film. And that some of the parts were done in CGI, but honestly, I find it hard to tell the difference. In fact, even knowing that it's CGI animated, I still find it hard to believe that it is CGI. It just looks so realistic.
But watching it, you'd find it hard to believe that it is animated with CGI. It really does look like it's stop motion, with the way the characters and the sets look. Not to mention the fact that they made the characters move in the way that the toys are restricted. It would have been easy for them to have just made this like a cutscene from a Lego video game, where the characters move unrealistically compared to the toys. But here they just go the extra mile to make it seem as realistic as possible. And this is honestly some of the best CG animation I've seen in a long time.
Fantastic.
Number 9. The surprise twist. This was one of those twists that I never saw coming the first time I watched this movie. And every time I rewatch it, I still find it an amazing twist. It's just really amazing to show that the whole movie was just a child playing with Lego toys the whole time. And the fact that his father was the inspiration for President Business, as well as looking like him and being played by the same guy, Will Ferrell.
This was one of those twists in movies that I literally didn't see coming. It could have easily just made the twist like really expected, like, oh, we know it's gonna happen, so just do it anyway. But this was really well done.
And I don't know if it's just me, but I think this is one of the few roles that Will Ferrell has had where he's not being comical or idiotic. This is honestly the first time I've seen Will Ferrell play a serious character. Of course, he would still be comical with Lord Business, but The Man Upstairs was definitely one of his more serious characters. And they even went so far to create this huge Lego set where Bricksburg was. And I just find it amazing to find that the whole adventure the whole time was just through the mind of a child. And the speech that Finn said that Emmett would give at the end was just really awesome. It was just so well written. This was an amazing twist that we never saw coming, and it's still among one of the best.
I am so pumped up!
Number 8. The cameos. When this movie was first announced, I honestly had no idea what story they were going to put behind the Lego Movie. Were they going to focus on just one franchise? Were they going to put several franchises into one? Were they going to create a new franchise completely? I honestly had no idea. but as soon as I saw the trailer, it was obvious that they were going to make some new characters for the film while combining some classic LEGO characters in the film as well. So we got many different characters that were already known from the past, like Chewbacca, Han Solo, Lando Calrissian, Gandalf, Dumbledore, DC characters, Michelangelo, minifigures characters, Johnny Thunder, Green Ninja from Ninjago, and Milhouse from the LEGO Simpsons? Yeah, the LEGO minifigure of Milhouse actually made a cameo in the LEGO movie before the LEGO Simpsons franchise was even released in the UK.
They must have really wanted to promote the LEGO Simpsons in the film, I guess.
Now, I'm not sure if it was released in the US before the UK, but I still find it really awesome to show that they promoted the figures in the movie. So whether you remember these characters from long ago or don't remember these characters from long ago, this movie is a great reminder for everything that you've ever known in the LEGO in the past, as well as giving a little nod to Bionicle. Whether they'll continue these cameos in the next films, it's really awesome to see all these old figures come together.
Have the young man step forward as you wish, Dumbledore.
I'm Gandalf!
Pronounce Dumbledore.
Dumbledore?
No, Dumbledore.
Fuck, you said Dumbledore.
Vitruvius!
Alright, you gotta write all that down because I'm not gonna remember any of it, but here we go.
Number 7. Vitruvius. This wizard voiced by the great Morgan Freeman was one of the funniest wizards I've ever seen. Yeah, we have had our funny wizards in the past, like Merlin from Sword in the Stone. But Vitruvius is another one of those funniest that I end up laughing at rather than just going, oh god, this is not funny. Quite honestly, Morgan Freeman is hilarious as Vitruvius. And I personally think that Freeman was the best choice for this character. And there was a lot of quirks about him. Like how wise he is, how forgetful he is, and the fact that he's blind. But one of the best moments for Vitruvius is definitely when he dies and becomes a ghost.
And because this movie went all out to make it seem like it was a kid playing with LEGO toys like they would in real life, they went all the way to make sure that Vitruvius was as realistic as a ghost as you could get. And by that I mean putting a piece of string on him and floating him around as if a kid was playing with him. I know a lot of people who actually laughed their heads off at that the first time they watched it.
The first time I watched that scene in the cinema, Ghost Vitruvius' appearance just cracked me the hell up. I honestly never expected to see a Ghost Vitruvius being hung up by a string. So whether you love wizards or not, there's no denying that Vitruvius will make you laugh on the floor.
I liked him before it was cool.
Number 6. Batman. This is, in my opinion, one of the funniest versions of Batman I've ever seen in media. And this character is so popular that he'll be getting his own spin-off movie in 2017.
In fact, some people have already made the argument that this version of Batman is better than Ben Affleck's Batman from Batman vs. Superman.
I find him to be a sort of LEGO version of the Adam West Batman. Like, comical, but most of the time taking his adventures seriously.
If anybody has black parts, I need them, okay? I only work in black. And sometimes very, very dark grey.
Some people might say that this was expected since Warner Brothers owns DC anyway. But they really made a Batman of their own here. And I honestly think he's one of the best versions of Batman I've ever seen. With his serious attitude, gruffy voice provided by Will Arnett, and that kick-ass song that he wrote. Darkness. I especially love the moments where he tries to keep his true identity a secret.
Bruce Wayne? Who's that? Sounds like a cool guy.
Yeah, we know you're Bruce Wayne, so stop making secrets.
While he isn't exactly the action-packed Batman that we all know Batman for, he's definitely one of the funniest Batmans.
So whether you're a fan of Batman or not, there's no denying that this version of the Caped Crusader is one of the funniest.
To the Batmobile!
To the invisible jet! Dang it.
Number 5. Benny is one of the funniest characters in the LEGO movie. And given the amount of characters I talked about in this list, that's saying a lot. Throughout the whole movie, Bennett was obsessed with building spaceships. And he's even tried to build a spaceship for their plans. But everybody's saying, no, you're not going to build a spaceship, we don't need a spaceship, which really makes him sad. And this is just a running gag. They do this every time Benny's on screen, giving him the chance to build a spaceship, only to have his heart broken and take down what he's already built.
while all those things about Fanny does make him a really likable character, it's the bit near the third act of the film that we really love, when he finally gets to build a spaceship.
But when he finally does get to build the spaceship, that's when he shines the most. He's so full of excitement that he just can't stop shouting out spaceship. The first time I saw this in the cinema, I can remember everybody in the screening room laughing their heads off at this. So for all these reasons, Benny is one of the funniest spacemen that we will never be forgetting anytime soon. Number 4. Everything is awesome. And by that I don't mean just the movie, I mean the song Everything is Awesome.
Oh my gosh, I love this song!
Yeah, some people might find it annoying as it's just like easy to remember lyrics and it just goes on for a while and it's just going Everything is Awesome. But I honestly find it really catchy, in a good way. It's sort of like when you sing Hakuna Matata for the first time, where it starts off okay, but for some people when they get older it just gets annoying, but for others it's just a still good song to them. And Everything is Awesome is still one of those songs that I just can't get out of my head. I even had it as a ringtone on my mobile phone a while back. No, I'm dead serious. The ringtone on my mobile phone was Everything is Awesome for a moment of time. And you can't really blame me for liking this song.
Everything is Awesome is another one of those really catchy songs that you can never get out of your head. With its catchy tune, easy to remember lyrics, and just how awesome it is.
Everything is Awesome is just another one of those awesome songs that you won't get out of your head for a long time.
Man, I feel so good right now! I can sing this song for hours!
Number 3. Bad Cop. This ruthless police officer, voiced by Liam Neeson, is one of the funniest characters I've ever seen in this movie. And I know I've said that quite a few times, but I just can't help it. Bad Cop is another funny character to me. One of the running jokes with him was the fact that he has two personalities in him. The main personality is Bad Cop, while the other personality is Good Cop, which is basically a Lego spoof on the whole Good Cop Bad Cop routine. But here they take it literally, where it's literally two cops in one.
Liam Neeson is one of my favourite actors, as I've seen him in the Star Wars prequel trilogy and in the Dark Knight trilogy. But this one as Bad Cop and Good Cop is definitely his funniest, because he gets to play two characters in one.
All units, cut him off on Elm, now, or whenever you can.
And I still today get a laugh out of both of these personalities, with Liam Neeson's fierce and gruffy voice as Bad Cop, and his kind, soft-hearted voice as Good Cop.
Hi, buddy. I'm your friendly neighborhood police officer.
Would you like a glass of water?
Yeah, actually, that's
too bad.
That still cracks me up.
And another one of the scenes where he really shines is when Bad Cop gets so angry that he can't help just kicking chairs around. And I'm pretty sure this one scene is a reference to The Simpsons. So whether you want a good cop or a bad cop, the bad cop is the right cop to go to.
Darn, 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 he darn!
Number 2. Unikitty. It should come as no surprise that Unikitty is another one of my favourite characters in the Lego movie. In fact, I love her so much that I actually made her a main character in Second Cup. Now, from what I can remember from being a kid, I was never really into girly characters, since I was a boy and I just liked boyish stuff. But I honestly have a very soft spot in my heart for the cute characters, such as Dot Warner and loads of others. And Unikitty's one of those characters that I really love, not just because of her cute personality, but also because of her hilarious rage that she shows off at the very end of the film.
Any idea is a good idea, except the not happy ones. Those you push down deep inside where you'll never, ever, ever,
ever
find them.
We already knew from her first appearance that she had some secret rage that turns her red, but we didn't get to see the full rage until near the end of the film during its climax. And boy was it worth the wait. And for those of you who are asking whether I'm going to show Unikitty in her rage in the future of Second Cup, then you're all going to have to wait and see. But I will say that it will be worth the wait to see her get angry in Second Cup.
And I don't know if I'm the only one in this boat, but I'm kind of hoping that they give Unikitty more screen time in the sequel. She deserves it.
So whether you like cute girly characters or not, Unikitty is going to have a soft spot in your heart. And she'll make you laugh every now and then.
Business. Numbers.
Yeah.
And the number one reason I think the Lego movie is awesome is... this is the Lego movie I always wanted to see. I bet that every kid like myself has done something like this with LEGO. Making up their own adventure where various characters from the different franchises all come together for one big adventure. And this movie does that. It brings pretty much every character we've ever known, from the old days to today, together into one film. And while Batman does get the most screen time out of all these classic characters, it is really nice to see all the classic characters in here again. Like the Star Wars characters and Johnny Thunder, who I can still remember and still have the minifigure of. As well as characters from before my time and even after my time as a child. And as I said, it makes a good homage to the Bionicle series, which is one of the most famous series in the LEGO franchise. But I swear that everybody who has ever grew up with LEGO will absolutely love this movie for bringing so many of these classic characters into one big film of all the new characters created for the film.
When I was a child, I used to love playing with LEGO all the time. In fact, I used to make up my own adventures with every character from every franchise mashed in together. Like, say, I'd have Star Wars characters mixed in with LEGO Island characters and so on and so forth. And this movie did a great job of bringing that childhood fantasy to life.
Throwing in a great story, some memorable new characters, some happy moments, some sad moments, some dramatic moments. And you got a movie that people were shocked didn't win an Academy Award. And in my opinion, I think this movie should have won an award. Honestly, the LEGO Movie worked really hard for that award. And I honestly think it deserves that award for putting so much time, love and effort into the film. I've gone on and on about this movie and how awesome it is. And this is the number one reason why I think it's awesome. Because, quite honestly, it's a perfectly written love letter to every LEGO fan's childhood.
And those are the 10 reasons why I think the LEGO Movie is awesome. And for those of you who have your own reasons to why the LEGO Movie is awesome, then get out there and share your opinions with everyone else and see what everyone else has to say. I'm Dino44, and I'll see you next time, folks.
Not Ringo.
Hey guys, Dino44 here. I need no introduction, but I got one anyway. If you're an animation fan like I am, then you would have most recently heard about the most recent passing away of Alan Young.
Alan Young, born the 19th of November 1919, was an English-born Canadian-American actor, voice actor, comedian, radio host and television host. He was best known by me for voicing Scrooge McDuck in various Disney films. And most recently he passed away on the 19th of May 2016 to natural causes. And he left a legacy behind him.
And I thought, what better way to commemorate the memory of this brilliant actor than by reviewing the film DuckTales the Movie Treasure of the Lost Land.
DuckTales the Movie, Treasure of the Lost Lamp is a 1990 animated adventure fantasy film based on the animated TV series DuckTales. It was produced by Disney company Disney Movie Toons, which was mostly known for doing the TV series that were made by Disney.
This movie was actually how I got into DuckTales in the first place. So is the movie as good as I remember it to be? Or is it just going to be a longer version of an episode? Well, let's take a look.
Scrooge McDuck, played by the late Alan Young and the gang, travels to the Middle East to find the treasure of Kalibaba. But unbeknownst to them, an evil sorcerer named Murloc, played by Christopher Lloyd, is on the lookout for the treasure too, as the treasure contains a magic lamp that the thief stole from him centuries ago. And he knows that with his magic talisman that could turn him into any animal, he could connect it to the lamp to gain unlimited wishes. So he uses an idiotic pickpocket named Dijon as their tour guide to get the lamp.
After all these centuries, The half will be mine again!
Yes, yes! You will become more powerful than locomotive! More faster than speedy bull! You will leap all buildings in a single sound!
But unfortunately for him, the lamp falls into the hands of Huey, Dewey, Louie and Webby, all voiced by Russie Taylor, who discovered that there's a genie inside the lamp, played by Rip Taylor, who just wants to have fun after years of imprisonment in the lamp. The kids use their free wishes to have fun, but when Scrooge finds out about the lamp, he of course uses it for his own selfish gains.
Well, obviously.
And eventually he's on the run from Murlock, who wants to take the lamp back and use it for his own evil, selfish deeds. And by some freak accident, Dijon ends up having the lamp and wishes to own Scrooge's fortune. As Scrooge and his family attempt to get the lamp back from Dijon and take back everything that was rightfully Scrooge's, Murlock steals the lamp and uses it for his own evil gains. So it's a big adventure to try and gain the lamp back from Murlock and undo all the evil things that he's been doing with the genie.
When I was a kid, I loved the movie a lot, but what do I think of it today? It still holds up even to this day.
This movie basically takes the whole plot that DuckTales was famous for. The gang going on adventures. And this was the first time I ever watched DuckTales. And before this movie, it was mainly adverts of DuckTales videotapes on various Disney videotapes that I used to have. So you could say that if it wasn't for the movie, I never would have gotten into DuckTales in the first place. And the biggest fear that most people have with movies based off of a TV series is that the movie could turn out to be like a longer episode of the show. But I never really felt that way, because each episode of DuckTales, even though I watched the show years later, actually felt like a mini-movie. So here they're just taking it up a notch by having it full length.
It could have been easy for them to have just made this like a longer version of an episode of DuckTales. But to me it doesn't really feel like a longer episode of the show. Well, maybe it was because it was the first thing I ever saw from DuckTales-wise.
And the characters that we all know from DuckTales are still the characters we all know in this movie. Scrooge McDuck, played by the late Alan Yun, is still the greedy, money-loving duck who just wants to make a quick buck, even though he's already a quadzillionaire. There's his accident-prone pilot Launchpad, who I think gets the proper screen time that he deserves. I just always found Launchpad to be one of the funniest characters. And his first few lines when he mentions that he never actually took flying lessons always cracked me up when I was young, and they still do to this day. Huey, Dewey, Louie and Webby, all voiced by Russie Taylor, are pretty much the same fun-loving rascals that they were in the TV series. As for the new characters, there's the Genie, played by Rip Taylor, who's basically a younger, tamer version of Genie from Aladdin. And I feel kind of bad for this guy since he was upstaged by Robin Williams when he played the Genie in Aladdin a few years later. But I can personally see why. I mean, this guy doesn't really come up with as many jokes as Robin Williams does, as Robin Williams improvised and came up with some more adult humour. But I think this Genie, played by Mr. Taylor, was a really good character. Because of his past, he was quirky and jumpy, but all in all, he just wanted to have fun after years of being imprisoned in the lamp. And then there's the villain of the movie, Murlock, who I'm quite honestly surprised that no one on the internet puts him on any top 10 Disney animated villains lists. Or as Animat said, puts him anywhere alongside Magica and Glumgold as the biggest DuckTales villains. He's been one of the most menacing characters of my childhood, and he's still one of the most menacing characters to this day. With his appearance, Christopher Lloyd's menacing voice, and his animal transformations as well.
This was the first time I ever heard Christopher Lloyd's voice in a movie. And it was also the first time I heard Christopher Lloyd as the villain. But that villain would later be upstaged by Judge Doom in Who Framed Roger Rabbit. But for the time, Murlock was really menacing, and he still is.
And I really do enjoy the relationship between Murlock and the Genie, and their backstories as well. They're just so well told that it explains who they are. Even though it's never really explained how long the two have lived for. And Murlock will stop at nothing to get the lamp back, even if it means killing off someone, even his own henchmen. And finally there's Dijon, Murlock's thieving and bumbling assistant. And he's the one character that might raise a few eyebrows, mainly because he has a thick accent, and would people see him as offensive now? And I personally never saw him as offensive, and I don't see him as offensive to this day. I mean, not everybody who's from his culture are pickpockets. And back then, people wouldn't have really thought twice about it, but these days, he might raise a few questions, like, is he offensive or is he not offensive?
I'm really not sure if Dijon is offensive now, since people's sensitivity has changed over time. So, is he racist now, or is he, like, not racist? I'm not sure. But either way, he gets a few funny lines every now and then.
Look what I did steal! Several beefballs, this dandy pocket watch, flops, and date nut bar, and two tickets to the Feta Cheese Festival. For you, master! Maybe you would like the floss?
These days, I find it a shame that this movie doesn't get as much attention as the TV series does. Though these days it is growing a big cult following with DuckTales fans, and it's still available on DVD for those to watch. And I bought it on DVD a couple of months back, and I still enjoy it to this day. And while the animation isn't exactly up there with some of the other animated films Disney have done, like Aladdin, The Lion King, Snow White, and all that stuff, it is a good improvement from the TV series' animation. I mean, the animation in the TV series was already top-notch, so they had to go up to even higher top-notch levels with this movie. And some bits of animation aren't really exactly up there with some of the other films I've mentioned, but it is really good animation compared to the TV series. And one of the biggest animation highlights in this movie is Murloc's animal transformations. I mean, it's just so amazing the way you see Murloc transform into these animals. A majority of his transformation scenes are done on-screen rather than off-screen, so you can literally see the guy turning into whatever animal he's turning into. That was freaking amazing at the time. So to me, DuckTales the Movie Treasure of the Lost Lamp is a great movie to add to your collection if you're a Disney and DuckTales fan. The characters are still the characters that we all know from the show, and the new characters will feel right at home in this movie. It's one of those films that doesn't really rely on adult jokes or anything, it's just more oriented towards kids and families, and that's exactly where it's supposed to be, since the show was pretty much for kids and families.
Each episode of the show was basically like a shortened movie. So with this movie, they're just going all the way. And boy, was it worth it.
So I would definitely recommend this movie to everyone who's ever been a DuckTales or Disney fan in general.
If you're a DuckTales fan or Disney animation fan in general, and I definitely recommend this movie. It's worth the watch if you're a Disney fan and a DuckTales fan.
And if LEGO ever considers doing a second series of Disney minifigures, then I would suggest doing one of Scrooge McDuck in honor of Alan Young. He deserves a LEGO Scrooge McDuck. I think Alan Young would have been really happy with that.
And this whole review was done in the memory of Alan Young, known to me as Uncle Scrooge McDuck. See you in the next life, Alan Young. You are my Scrooge.
Not Ringo.
You know, you gotta wonder whether or not your Lego minifigures have voice stuff all over them. Hence the 3D glasses. Well, if it worked for the 10th Doctor, I'm sure it'll work for me. What started this void stuff investigation, you may ask? The latest addition to the LEGO franchise, LEGO Dimensions.
LEGO Dimensions is a LEGO science fantasy action adventure video game developed by TT Games and published by Warner Bros. Interactive Entertainment for the PlayStation 4, PlayStation 3, Wii U, Xbox One and Xbox 360. It follows the toy-to-life format that Skylanders and Disney Infinity had, where you could play as several LEGO characters within one game.
When this video game was announced, I didn't know what to expect from it. The trailers made it look awesome, but was it really going to be as awesome as they were saying it would be? Or would it just be a cop-out just to get people to buy more props? Well, let's take a look.
The story begins in a wavy desert-like dimension with a hidden planet known as Foundation Prime. The evil Lord Vortech, played by Gary Oldman, and his former minion Expo seek the 12 Foundation Elements, the cornerstones of time and space itself, in a bid to merge all universes into one under his control. And during his search for the Foundation Elements, three LEGO characters, Wildstar from the LEGO movie, Batman from DC Comics, and Gandalf from Lord of the Rings, all sense this investigation and decide to team up and stop Lord Vortech from collecting all the Foundation Elements before he finds them and takes over the world. And while trying to save all dimensions from Vortech, they're also out to save Robin, Frodo, and Metalbeard from Vortech. And along the way, they come across several other LEGO characters, including Homer Simpson, Doc Brown, the Doctor, the Ghostbusters, and many others. And the whole adventure is just several twists and turns leading to several LEGO dimensions and meeting several LEGO characters along the way.
With how popular the LEGO franchise already is, it would have been easy for the makers just to have made this video game slapped it together with no effort at all. But it was a really, really good game.
The game features characters and worlds from 14 different franchises, including DC Comics, Lord of the Rings, The Lego Movie, The Wizard of Oz, The Simpsons, Lego Ninjago, Doctor Who, Back to the Future, Portal 2, Ghostbusters, Midway Arcade, Scooby-Doo, Legends of Chima, and Jurassic World. And it would have been really easy to have just slapped this video game together with no time or effort put into it. But the writers actually did put a good effort into making this video game. Not only was it not just a ploy to get people to buy more products, but it was a really well-written story.
The reactions of the characters and the different worlds they come from and go to are just exactly what you'd expect from these characters.
Like, I love how the two Batmans from DC and the Lego movie fight with each other as soon as they meet.
Where did you come from? And why are there two Batmen?
This video game uses the same format as Skylanders, Amiibo and Disney Infinity does, where the player takes a USB portal and figurines to put it on. But unlike its competitors, the figurines and models are buildable. And while you do get the paper instruction for the minifigures and the starter pack, you do have to get the instructions from the video game itself, when you either have to add components to the gateway or build gadgets and vehicles. All the instructions are included within the game as soon as you log the new character into it. But for the characters with the LEGO packs, you actually have to play the level to obtain these gadgets and vehicles. I found that out when I got the Doctor Who level pack. The main characters are Batman, voiced by Troy Baker, who gives a good feel to the Dark Knight as he should be in the comic books, as well as a little bit of a comedic side to it, but not so much that he's an exact copy of the LEGO movie Batman.
Who are you? What did you do to us? Is he always like this, Wildstyle?
There's Gandalf the Grey, voiced by Tom Kane, who you may remember as Professor Utonium in the Powerpuff Girls. He's basically the same old Gandalf that he was in the Lord of the Rings and Hobbit movies, and I find it really funny how he makes fun of all the futuristic things that he sees in various dimensions compared to his own timeline.
Can someone explain to me what's going on, please?
And the last main character you play as is Wildstyle, voiced by Elizabeth Banks from the Lego movie. And she's pretty much the same old Wildstyle we knew in the Lego movie. And other characters in this game include Lego Doc Brown, played by Christopher Lloyd, Two-Face, the Joker, Harley Quinn, voiced by Tara Strong, All 13 incarnations of the Doctor, the main one being the 12th Doctor played by Peter Capaldi, while all the other 12 is just really archived recordings of all the other actors. What I also think is a nice touch for the Doctor Who character is that every time one of the Doctors goes into the TARDIS interior, the TARDIS console room changes into whatever TARDIS console room each Doctor had. So like with the first Doctor you'd have the first console room, with the 8th Doctor you have the movie console room, and with the 9th and 10th Doctors you get the console room that I was introduced to. And with Tom Baker you get two console rooms. One which was the traditional white TARDIS console room with the circle fins, and the other one was the wooden one that he had in a few episodes before. And I think that's really awesome. Other Doctor Who characters include Jack Harkness, voiced by John Barrowman, and he actually gets to sin in this game. Clara Osborne, voiced by Jenna Coleman. The always hilarious Missy, voiced by the always hilarious Michelle Gomez. An unexpected surprise for me was Davros, voiced by Julian Bleach, as a main villain in the Doctor Who level pack, The Extermination of Earth. And Nick Briggs comes in providing his voice for the Daleks and the Cybermen. And that's really awesome to me.
The Doctor must be exterminated. Daleks come to punch the sky. You will be exterminated. Obey the Daleks.
Locate the Doctor.
Exterminate, annihilate, destroy. We are the supreme beings. Enemies of the Daleks will be exterminated. Do not move.
Silence!
And with the LEGO Lord of the Rings dimension, the only characters that have their original voice actors is Legolas and Gimli, which is basically just archived recordings of the original actors from the movies. And it even has Roger L. Jackson as Saruman. Yeah, I'm not even kidding. Mojo Jojo himself plays Saruman the White.
I am Saruman the White. I am not a bad guy.
And all the LEGO movie characters are basically voiced by the same actors that played them in the movie. And the only two actors that don't come in to voice the original characters are Liam Neeson as Bad Cop and Good Cop, since he just uses archive recordings, and Will Ferrell also doesn't come back to voice Lord Business, probably because he was busy doing something else. So they just got an actor to try and do an impression of Will, and it almost succeeds. And all the LEGO characters from The Wizard of Oz are basically just a load of actors who are trying to sound like the original voice actors, and all the Simpson characters that actually do talk are just archive recordings. And I honestly don't get why they didn't get the original actors to voice the characters with new lines. It's kind of weird for me, but I think it works okay. As for the new characters, there's Expo, a little robot who used to work for Lord Zortek before he was betrayed. And now he helps out the heroes with finding the foundation elements. He cracks some wise jokes, but really does care about keeping the dimensions intact. And my all-time favourite new character in this video game is Lord Vortek, voiced by Gary Oldman. This guy is just so despicably evil and loves every second of it. And I could just imagine how much fun Gary Oldman must have been having voicing this character.
It would seem the mice have escaped from my maze. And for some reason, I cannot locate them.
So, Professor Joker, what do we do if we can't find them?
We make them find us.
Precisely.
Gary Oldman is just so friggin' awesome as Lord Vortek. And I personally think they should make him an exclusive minifigure of this character. And if they're considering making a sequel to LEGO Dimensions, I'd definitely bring Gary Oldman back to voice him. He's evil, knows it, loves it, and Gary Oldman was so friggin' awesome as the character.
Elvis is finding my foundation elements! Every time I send you fools to retrieve one, they're right behind you!
Now, if I do have any complaints with this video game, it's the fact that some LEGO franchises don't get shown into this game. Mostly the stuff owned by Disney, like Star Wars and Marvel and all that stuff. Now, it's not a major complaint, but I play the game enjoying it, but also thinking how much cooler it might have been with Star Wars characters. I mean, wouldn't you love to see Darth Vader interacting with the Daleks or something? And I can honestly just imagine something like the battle droids or the stormtroopers fighting against the Cybermen. That'd be so funny. And the Marvel characters don't show up either. Like, just think about how cool it would have been to have had the Marvel superheroes interacting with the DC superheroes. But that's just a minor nitpick, and the fact that they're not in it doesn't really come close to ruining what was a really good game. And once you've completed the game completely, or if you're still in the middle of completing the game, you can still use whatever character you want to besides the three main characters. As soon as I got the Doctor Who level pack, I used the Doctor for pretty much every mission I've gone on. And ever since I've completed the game and gone back to get some secret items, I've always used Unikitty alongside the Doctor for a laugh. Just like with my review of the LEGO TARDIS console set, I like to use Unikitty as the Doctor's companion in LEGO Dimensions. Because I love Unikitty and I just think it's a good laugh. And you can combine as many of these characters with any of the characters like the Doctor as you want to. And that's the whole fun of it. This was the last video game that I was to get last year before 2016. And it is a really great game and it's worth adding to your collection if you're a LEGO fan.
LEGO Dimensions has a lot to offer for me. Various characters, apart from Marvel and Star Wars characters since they're owned by Disney. A lot of the good comedy and action stuff you expected from the previous video games. And it's just so freaking awesome to play. In fact, it's so awesome, it's almost like a movie.
This is a LEGO video game that I would definitely recommend for anyone who's a LEGO fan in general. It's got great action, great animation, characters we know and love, introductions to various franchises in LEGO like Jurassic World, Ghostbusters and Doctor Who, and it will have you entertained for hours on end.
So if you're a LEGO fan, I'd definitely say go out there and buy LEGO Dimensions. You won't be disappointed. I'm Dali44, and I'll see you next time, folks. Alright, Unikitty's got no void stuff. Let's check another one. Ah, Darth Vader.
Not Ringo.
I consider myself a lover of nostalgia, a lover of things that I grew up with. Wait, actually that's pretty much the same as lover of nostalgia, scratch that one. A person who has some faith that movies based off of things I grew up with will turn out to be as not exactly as good as the original, but at least okay and decent. Until 2012. When that faith was shattered by a cat who lives in New York. This is the gateway to bullshit that Hollywood has decided to call Top Cat the Movie. This really bad movie, also known as Top Cat and His Gang in Spain, is a 2011 3D Mexican animated movie based off of the popular Hanna-Barbera cartoon series Top Cat. This movie was made due to the show's insane popularity in Spain compared to all the other countries. And boy does this movie blow. The movie basically starts with Top Cat and his friends doing what they do best. But as soon as a new female cat named Trixie comes into the picture, Top Cat tries to put some swinging moves on her. Meanwhile, at the police station, Officer Dibble gets fired by the chief's son-in-law, Strickland, who's bent on taking over the police station by using robots instead of people. Now, where have I heard this plot before?
Anyway, he installs security cameras all over the city of New York to make sure that nobody commits any crime on his watch. But when he sees Top Cat as a threat, he frames Top Cat for a crime he didn't commit and gets him sent to dog jail. Really? Why the hell would they send a cat to a dog prison?
That's idiotic!
And it's up to Top Cat's gang, Officer Dibble and Trixie, to free Top Cat from dog prison and stop Strickland's evil plans to take over New York.
Now this is a story that could work for Top Cat or any other cartoon character that existed in the past. But it all depends on whether it's written right. And this movie is not.
As I said, this story could work for another movie. But here it's just cliched and just has every tired joke that you would expect from it. Like the silly cats landing on their feet joke.
Luckily, cats always land on their feet.
This lightning never strikes twice in the same place joke.
At least lightning never strikes the same place twice!
Well, at least one of the characters actually sounds like the original voice actors.
And many others that we've heard a bajillion times before. Okay, so bad jokes is one thing, but what about the characters? Well, to be honest, I find myself not enjoying these characters as much as I did in the original TV series. There's Top Cat, voiced by Jason Harris Katz.
So, let me get this straight. Number 274 from Codename Kids Next Door is the voice of Top Cat.
And if I'm honest, his voice for Top Cat doesn't suit the character. And I know that he is trying to sound like the original character, but it just doesn't work for me. But on the plus side, they did get someone to sound exactly like Benny for the role of Benny. And all the other characters do try their best to sound like the original actors, but it's just not as good as the original actors. And then there's the villain of the movie, Strickland, who's basically the old-fashioned cliché of many villains that we've seen a bajillion times before. Not good-looking. Full of himself, very vain, wants to take over the world with technology, and a bunch of other boring stuff we've seen a million times before.
This villain is just so cliched that you could pretty much put him in any other movie and it wouldn't change a thing.
Then there's his right-hand cat, Trixie, who's become the love interest of Top Cat. And she's basically the old-fashioned cliché of the hench girl working for the villain and then going against the villain when she finds out his true intentions. And she could work for another movie and some people might really like her, but I just find her to be an old-fashioned cliché of villains we've seen loads of times before. And if you don't like the jokes and the characters that much, then don't worry, there's plenty of other things to hate in this movie. Like the animation. The animation is a mix between 2D characters and 3D backgrounds and vehicles and other objects. But these characters' designs really don't look as good as the original Hanna-Barbera designs. In fact, this style is making the original Hanna-Barbera cartoon look superb. I mean, the original show had better animation than this. And I don't get why they place 2D characters in a 3D world. I mean, that doesn't always work every time you try it. Okay, it worked for the Hanna-Barbera simulator ride in Universal Studios, but I just don't see it working for a big screen movie, especially one like this. But I have to admit, I do kind of like that they have the original theme song on a big screen movie.
And the funny thing is, when this movie was announced, I read a newspaper article saying how bad the animation was, and not one bit of that article talked about the story. So I went to check it out myself to see how the story would be compared to the animation. And it turned out the story itself was as bad as the animation.
And because that newspaper article review didn't talk about the story, but instead how crap the animation was, I found out how bad the story was the hard way. And when you go to HMV, the DVDs actually have the nerve to say that it's fun for the whole family. Which I personally think is a pile of bullshit. And as I said in the beginning of this review, this movie was so bad that it made me lose my faith in movies based off of nostalgic things.
Oh man.
And then next year, it was the Lego Movie that brought back the faith.
Yes!
Top Cat has become a big household name for many animation fans since its early debut to today. So many people who watched the original show growing up really take it seriously and hate this movie. And who could blame them? Everything about this movie is just half-assed, cheesy, and just downright lazy. I mean, not that I expected the movie to be as good as the TV series, but I did expect something. But instead got one hell of a badly animated, badly written, and just bad movie in general. Hell, just watching the original cartoon show is more exciting than watching this bullshit.
And I do know that this movie was made for young children, but that's no excuse. Just because a movie's intended for young children, that doesn't give Hollywood the right not to try. they're good at something, then they can make anything enjoyable. Even if it's based off of something that existed in the past.
So if you have kids of your own and you want to introduce them to Top Cat, then I definitely suggest starting with the cartoon. And just staying as far away as possible from this piece of shit movie. You'll thank me for it.
And I pray to God that the studio that made that movie does not make another movie based off of Top Cat.
Duh, it's the Hollywood system.
No. No!
Ringo.
Hey guys, Dalek44 here. I need no introduction, but I got one anyway. Is everybody sick and tired of waiting a whole year for Doctor Who yet?
If you're like me, then you're obviously bored of waiting for Doctor Who Series 10 to come out. I mean, honestly, it's just a pain in the ass that we gotta wait a whole bloody year for another series. So to relieve the boredom, I've started watching previous Doctor Who episodes from 2005 to Series 9. Just to relieve the boredom anyway. And boy, is it bloody worth it. Watching them, I don't mean the wait. It's just becoming a pain in the ass now.
And very recently, I put on an episode from Series 2 called Love and Monsters.
Love and Monsters is the 10th episode of the second series of Doctor Who, first broadcast on BBC One on the 17th of June 2006. Written by Russell T. Davis, and many years later is considered to be one of the worst episodes in the show's history.
But 10 odd years after its official release, is it really worth so much hate that it gets?
Well, to understand everybody's hatred to the episode, we first have to look at the story. The whole episode takes place as a video diary of a man named Elton, not to be confused with, played by Mark Warren, a young man who is describing his encounters with the Doctor, played by David Tennant.
And that's the first complaint that people have with this episode. The Doctor's barely in it.
Elton's on-camera narration forms a present-day frame story of the series of flashbacks related to the Doctor, and his investigations for the Doctor leads him to a woman named Ursula Blake, played by Shirley Henderson, who you may remember from Harry Potter, who is with a group of people who are also trying to investigate the Doctor. Bridget, Bliss, and Mr. Skinner. And with the help of Elton, they formed the group Linda, which stood for London Investigation and Detective Agency. At the beginning, they all talk about the Doctor and what he could be and what he might represent. Then they start having some more fun, like bringing food and singing ELO songs, since Elton is a huge fan of ELO. And who could blame him? But then one day a man named Victor Kennedy, played by Peter Kay, interrupts the meeting and points out that Linda has lost focus. Using files that he obtained from the Torchwood Institute, he uses the help of Linda to try and find the Doctor. When their investigations to find the Doctor fail, they move to a new tactic to try and find his companion Rose Tyler. And Elton's search for Rhodes leads him to her mother, Jackie Tyler. He manages to meet her at the Launderette and is invited to her apartment to fix various things. At first they try to be friends, but Elton forgets about trying to seduce her into telling him about the Doctor. They start to become friends, but then that friendship ends as soon as she finds out the truth. And all the time, Bridget and Bliss disappear from the group unexpectedly. And after the event with Jackie, Elton, Ursula and Mr. Skinner stage a walkout because everything has gone wrong in the group ever since Victor turned up. But while Elton and Ursula are doing their walkout, they have to go back to collect Ursula's phone, only to discover that Victor Kennedy is an alien that likes to call himself the Absorbaloth. And it was turned out that he actually absorbed all the former members of Linda, which leads to Ursula getting absorbed by the creature, Elton meeting up with the Doctor, and finding out the truth of why he was there when he was a child.
Most Whovians consider this to be one of the worst episodes in the series since its revival in 2005. Me personally, I think it's good. Not one of the best episodes, I'll admit, but it is a good episode.
This episode was the first time we've hardly ever seen the Doctor or his companion in the show, from what I can remember, since I never really watched that many classic episodes. But I honestly don't mind that. It's just watching the whole film from the point of view of someone who's encountered various aliens, as well as the Doctor. And I honestly just found it interesting to know that this guy met the Doctor when he was a child, before he even knew anything about this guy. It was especially a nice touch when they showed flashbacks of previous episodes that took place in present-day London, such as the Auton attack in Rose, the Slovene spaceship crashing into Big Ben in Aliens of London, and the Sycorax ship above London in the Christmas Invasion. Those are really nice callbacks to previous alien invasions.
I thought it was really nice to see all those flashbacks to the previous invasions, like the Autons, the Slovene ship, and the Sycorax ship. It was just some nice touches.
And I thought the guy they got to play, Elton, did a really good job of his character, because this guy has a lot to act through. He has to play Elton telling the story, and Elton going through the story. That's quite a few things for one actor to do, isn't it? And I honestly think he plays the part really well. The Doctor and Rose, for whatever scenes they are in, are good, the other side characters are good, and let's talk about Peter Kay as Victor Kennedy, the Absorbaloth.
We all know that Peter Kay is a very hilarious comedian with everything he's been in, and this episode was no exception.
Peter Kay has been in a lot of comedic roles at this time, and this is the first time he's ever been in a Doctor Who episode. And I personally love his character. He starts off as a human being with a very posh accent, while still showing off a bit of the northern accent, who's trying to find out who the Doctor is, and then by the end when he reveals his alien self, he also starts using his traditional northern accent. And as I said, even though Peter Kay tries to do a very posh British accent and kind of succeeds, you can still hear his traditional northern accent in there. But I think he still does a pretty good job. And some people say that the Absorbaloth is one of the worst looking monsters in the show's history. But few people forget that this monster was actually designed by a child who entered a Blue Peter competition. I mean, if I knew about this competition, then I would have entered it. And I personally wouldn't have cared if I'd won or not. I would have just loved to have entered it in this competition.
Despite the fact that many Whovians consider this to be one of the worst episodes, it does have a lot of good stuff in it. Like, for example, it started the Saxon Mystery. Yeah, I'm not joking. If you look at the scene before the Absorbaloth reveals himself from behind the newspaper, you'll see an article on the back page saying, Saxon leads polls by 64%. And that's one of the good things in the episodes, the fact that it started the mystery of Mr. Saxon.
I also thought it was a really nice touch to have ELO songs playing, since I love ELO. It started off with my parents loving ELO from when they were starting to listen to it, and then they passed it on to me. Well, okay, most of the songs were just Mr. Blue Sky and Don't Bring Me Down, but they're two of my favourite songs anyway. So despite the fact that fans claim this to be the worst episode, I personally think it doesn't deserve any of the bashing it gets. I mean, yeah, the Doctor and Rose are barely in it, and you can obviously see Peter Kay's face in the monster costume, but I personally thought that it was pointless to have Peter Kay as a monster without seeing Peter Kay's face. And I also thought it was a really nice touch to have the Absorbaloth beam from Vatsacorcus Albatorius' twin planet, since he looked very Slovenish, as Rose said.
Me personally, I really do like this episode. I wouldn't say it's one of the best episodes, far from it, but it is a decent episode.
So me personally, I don't think that this episode deserves all the bashing it gets. It's a decent episode with a decent plot. Russell T. Davis tried something new and not many people liked it, but at least he had the balls to try something new. I mean, that's what the show is about, isn't it? Trying something new. Plus, Blink, an episode that came years later, had very little of the Doctor and his companion, and no one had a heart attack over that. But that's probably because it introduced us to the Weeping Angels, who are arguably the scariest Doctor Who monsters in the show's history. But all that aside, Love and Monsters doesn't deserve to be overlooked or even said as the worst episode in my opinion. It's a decent episode with a decent plot, and I always enjoyed watching it, even though I wouldn't really watch it a million times over and over again like I do with the Cybermen and Dalek episodes. But it is definitely worth a good watch, and doesn't deserve to be overlooked and ignored. And if you haven't seen this episode yet, then check it out for yourselves and see what you have to say about it.
I'm Dalek44, and I'll see you next time, folks.
Ringo.
I need no introduction, but I got one anyway. Well, I got my double bed, I got my check out my six-pack t-shirt on. You know what that means. More adverts!
Thomas has never had. I know it seems like a silly idea to review adverts, but it's like I said before. They live in their own little worlds that want to scam us and be nice to us at the same time. And there's just so much to talk about and make fun of with these adverts. And these adverts gave us a lot of the things we pestered our parents for in the 90s and early 2000s.
And we're here to look at them again today. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the second tribute to 90s and early 2000s adverts in another segment I like to call, Don't Go Away.
Does anyone here remember Hornby Railway? Of course you do, everyone does. It's one of the biggest selling model trains in all of the world. And one of the most popular franchises was for Thomas the Tank Engine. But this advert for Hornby was a very interesting one.
I just got this Thomas and Bertie set for my birthday.
Then I got the Intercity 225 for Christmas. And then?
Then I got Sirius.
Wow, that kid was really hardcore about getting serious with Hornby. If he gets any more Hornby, he'll be able to do his own fan-made Thomas show.
So it's basically a clever way that if you collect enough Hornby model railway trains and railway tracks, then you could build big sets in the future. So yeah, good way to sell the product, isn't it?
Hornby Railways. Start the way you mean to carry on.
Eat up now or you can't go to bed early.
Oh, come on now. It'll be no early night.
Wait. If you don't behave well, you don't get to go to bed early? What the hell would any kid want to go to bed early?
Yes, even though it is very weird that children would actually want to have an early night, this was actually a pretty interesting way to advertise Silent Night bedding.
Yes. We've got them these new beds from Silent Night. They're called My First Bed. There's loads of fun options. And they've got the special Miracoil mattresses like our bed.
And this was back in the late 90s and early 2000s when Silent Night was all the rage. So I guess they would have tried anything to sell their products.
Sleep tight.
Have a Silent Night.
There is Peter Pan's Island over there.
This was from back in the day when Peter Pan Return to Neverland came in the cinema. So of course it would make sense to make Peter Pan themed toys. And the two ones that got advertised the most were Peter Pan's Island and Captain Hook's ship.
Here, Captain Hook is here.
Pirate ship goes to sea for to capture Peter Pan.
But if it was Disney related, then the kids were gonna love it anyway.
Peter Pan's Island over there, the lost children will be banned. There is Peter Pan's Island over there.
You remember these old Baby Bell adverts, right? Some guy will be trying to eat his baby bell and then something interrupts him by having the baby bell fall out of his hand and he has to go all the way around the city to chase it.
I mean, it's not like you could just go to the shop and buy a new baby bell. No, 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 you gotta go and chase that baby bell that ran away. Sensible, really.
Yeah, pretty stupid thing to do when you can just easily buy a new one from the shop. But you can't knock it for being a clever way to advertise the stuff.
Mini Baby Bell, all round goodness.
Ba 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 baby bell.
Buckaroo!
How many of you remember Buckaroo? It was one of the best known games of my childhood.
Be careful, because Buckaroo's a bad tempered old mule.
The rules of it are pretty simple. You place stuff on the back of a horse without making it buck, and whoever makes it buck loses. So, such to be that.
I remember seeing a You've Been Framed clip of a kid playing Buckaroo but then smashes it away when he loses. No, I'm serious, that actually did happen. The kid got so pissed off at losing Buckaroo that he actually pushed it away.
At any moment, he might decide to buck Buckaroo for a Buckaroo-ting good time.
This was back in the early 2000s when the final season of Dexter's Laboratory was coming. And what better way to advertise it than have a CGI laboratory and music from the Spider-Man movies?
Voice online. Laboratory online. Activate robots. Checking robotic systems. Activate machines. Initiate laser. Loading new series Dexter's Laboratory.
If Dexter's Laboratory was going to end its glorious run on Cartoon Network, it was going to make sure they advertised the last season in the coolest way possible.
Dexter's Laboratory. Every day at 4:30 p.m. on Cartoon Network.
What for lunch?
It's hungry, hungry hippos!
Ah, yes. Hungry, hungry hippos. That delightful game where you play as hippos that stuff their faces with white balls. And whoever collects the most balls wins.
It's hungry, hungry hippos. First to gobble up the most marbles wins.
Hungry, hungry hippos. We're hungry, hungry hippos.
This is one of those games that still continues to be sold in the shops to this day.
But I was around when that first came up, and don't you forget it.
So whether you're from the 90s or the 2000s, you're still going to be entertained by this game.
We're in an eating race.
How's about dessert?
What is that?
That is Ed.
How about that?
How many of you remember Ed, Ed, and Eddie?
No,
it was one of the best shows on Cartoon Network.
No, you said he was
and
Ed.
They had a pretty funny way to advertise the show, too, when it was first announced.
Which Ed? What is that?
That is Ed.
How about that?
That's Ed.
I thought he was Ed.
No, he's Ed.
Is that not what I said?
No, you said he was Ed.
Is he an Ed, too?
Well, he's an Ed, but he's not Ed.
Which Ed is he not?
Neither one. He's Eddie.
So he gets a Y.
A Y.
Even though this was a very strange Ed, Ed, and Eddie version of Abbott and Costello's Who's On First, it was a really great way to promote the new show. And the show turned out to be great, too.
Why?
That's right.
But he's an Ed because he starts with Ed.
No, he starts with Ed and Ed catches up.
So it's Eddie, Ed, and Ed.
No, it's Ed, Ed, and Eddie.
What's the difference?
It's much less confusing that way.
Is he not?
So whether you loved Ed, Ed, and Eddie or Cartoon Network in general or both,
that's right.
And you were definitely going to love this promo for this show.
No, he starts with Ed and
Ed. And the show, of course.
Ed, Ed, and Eddie, coming this January to Cartoon Network.
Sophie, who do you like best, Daddy or Chips?
This was back in the day when McCain wanted to advertise their products in the most silly ways possible. Some of them would be about the microchips, and some of them would be about the oven chips and the home fries. But this one was asking a basic question. Does a little girl like her daddy or chips the most?
Daddy or chips? Daddy or chips?
And throughout the whole advert, she ponders and ponders and ponders, until finally...
Daddy Chips.
Oh, noodles. McCain Chips, Britain's most popular choice.
Chips.
I know how you feel, kid. I'd pick chips over my own BFF after he stole a fish finger from me.
So even though the girl might be being a little bit too harsh on the dad for taking one minuscule chip from her plate, you can't knock it for being an interesting and funny way to advertise the stuff.
McCain, you just can't help yourself.
Shreddies has had his fair share of adverts back in the day, but my absolute favourite were these ones, where some kid was enjoying himself when some snooty know-it-all comes in to spoil it all.
How dare
when you insist on playing this modern music so loud? Now make yourself useful and pour me some frosted shredded, you monkey-brained idiot!
Christ! Those shreddies must have had a fuckload of sugar in them at the time.
It's the wicked stuff on frosted shreddies and cocoa shreddies that makes them just too tasty for geeks!
I guess that little shrimp must have been very geeky then.
Frosted shreddies and cocoa shreddies! Too tasty for geeks!
Ah yes, the only times when people were actually interested in giving away free books. And what better way to do so than with walkers?
But why do they have to be full packs, miss?
They just do.
That has to be the funniest reply I have ever heard. You could put that reply to any question asked.
Tell me, how do the packs feel?
They just do.
Tiny, why'd you have to turn the day off?
They just do.
Alright, hold on a second. I just need to talk about this advert real quick. In these adverts, you've got Gary Lineker, who's going to these extremely, insanely extreme lengths just to get other people's bags of walkers. Why doesn't he just go to the fucking shop? I mean, Jesus, it's incredibly stupid the lengths he'll go to. Plus, his face used to be on the fucking bag. You'd think he'd be able to get a few free ones every once in a while.
They just do.
So even though Gary clearly has a problem with walkers and is obsessed with it, you can't help but laugh at these adverts every time you see.
Crisp.
There's a magical place in the heart of Europe where the stars of Disney animated film classics become your friends. Disneyland Paris.
This was back when Disney decided to advertise their new theme park in Paris on their VHSs. And they did it in a lot of their classic films releases. So even though the Queen of Hearts used to scare the hell out of me when I was a kid, it's still a very whimsical way to advertise their theme park.
Someone you know can't wait to go. Disneyland Paris.
After years of training, Kellogg's new secret weapon is ready.
Oh yeah, this was back in the days when Kellogg's wanted to try something new besides cereal. And what better thing to try than turning your favourite cereals into a bar with milk in it?
Does anybody in the audience have Arnold Schwarzenegger's phone number? I think I just found his lost pet cow.
And this was a very clever way to advertise it too. You've got a cow with a milk gun, he's moving around some obstacle courses, treating it like it's a secret agent mission. Kind of like a Mission Impossible movie, if you will.
Introducing Hooter the Cow and new Kellogg's cereal and milk bars, the delicious, crunchy, crumbly snack.
And if you're watching this, Arnold Schwarzenegger, you found your cow.
Good night, everybody.
So, when hunger hits,
make it.
It is your friend, Smil. Hit me with the HP-105.
Sarge?
I said,
oh my god, I fucking love this guy. He used to advertise Super Soakers back in the 90s. And he just blew our heads off with laughter.
And why they never brought back this legend for the Super Soaker outfits in the future is beyond me. I mean, seriously, why didn't they bring him back? He's a fucking legend.
And with Super Soaker still being made today, I'm honestly hoping that they bring this guy back to advertise his stuff. He's a legend.
My toothache!
No worries, I'm the Crocodile Dentist!
How many of you remember Crocodile Dentist? It was a fun little game where you could pick at a crocodile's teeth. But if you pick at the wrong one, it bites you.
The game's Crocodile Dentist! Take turns pulling teeth, but don't pull the wrong one or he'll snap and you're out!
It's funny how in the animated bits, the crocodile really looks like he wants the dentist's help. Whereas the actual fin looks like it doesn't want help. And it looks vicious when it bites you.
What a mouthful! I'm the Crocodile Dentist!
But eh, it's still a fun game.
Well, as long as it doesn't encourage kids to be dentists to a real crocodile, then it'll be okay.
I feel so much better!
Crocodile Dentist!
From Milton Bradley!
Dang nabbit, I can never find a parking space after lunch.
Remember when Cartoon Network used to do promos with their various characters that they showed from the new cartoons to the classic cartoons? Well, this was one of the best ones.
Cartoon Network keeps adding stars without adding parking space.
There's a space
reserved for Papa Smurf.
Bloody freaking die.
Wise Papa Smurf, corrupted by his own power, can no leader go undated.
This is basically what people experience every day in their lives, where they go out somewhere and they can't find a parking space. And this is hilarious.
I mean, how funnier can you get with this? You've got Fred Flintstone, He-Man and Chicken in the same car as each other looking for a space. Unsuccessful.
Hey fellas, looking for a parking space? You can take mine.
Now this guy's a true hero.
Could have sworn I parked in the Wally Gator F lot. Or was it in... Boy.
Now I remember. I flew into work today. Silly me.
Oh, brother.
Oh man, look, there's one!
Alright boys, I need your foot power to help me gun it.
Totally worth watching all the way through.
You don't have any sense.
So even though Cartoon Network isn't as good as it was in the old days, we could still look back at these old promos to remember the golden age.
That does it. I'm gonna start taking the bust away.
This is war. And the enemy?
Those new M&M's minis?
Bingo.
Oh yes, the M&M's Minis. A new idea that M&M's came up with just to brand out their brand.
It's time to let them know who's boss.
The President?
No.
Prime Minister?
No.
Queen of England?
No. Us.
Oh.
Sorry, I got a half right.
Now go up there and get that tube! Hurry up!
Hey, look!
Listen up, you little...
And I'm not really sure why they discontinued the M&M's Minis. Maybe they weren't popular enough, maybe they grew out of fashion. But either way, this was a really interesting way to advertise some stuff.
New M&M's Minis, they're headed your way.
How are you with apologies?
We are so sorry!
Oh yeah, these were my absolute favourite Magic Roundabout movie trailers, where they'd show two characters at a time in each trailer and talk a little bit about them before announcing the movie. And my absolute favorite was when they did Seabad and Soldier Sam.
He's the Twisted Wizard with an evil brain.
I know. It's a gift, really.
He's the Trusty Trooper with no brain at all.
Sam, you're ruining the moment.
Tom Baker as Seabad, Ray Winston as Soldier Sam, the Magic Roundabout.
Gruesome.
Hey folks, remember when they used to use rejected Simpsons characters to advertise Harvest Bread? Of course you don't, no one does. It didn't last very long, did it?
Right, Mum, I want plenty of greens, and from now on buy only brown bread.
Brown!
It's good for you. Top models eat it.
Don't care. I know what I like, and that's white, white.
Those kids kind of look like they should belong to the Tracy Ullman Simpson sketches. Seriously, look at the two together. They really do look like they belong in Tracy Ullman.
Introducing new Hovis Best of Both. Delicious soft white bread, but with all the goodness of brown.
At last! Something you agree on! Well, it was his fault.
You started it.
No, I didn't!
Man, these kids will fight over anything, won't they?
It was his fault.
You started it.
No, I didn't!
New Hovis Best of Both. Delicious soft white bread, with all the goodness of brown.
Chip here, new Cookie Crisp cereal there.
How many of you remember Cookie Crisp cereal? It was an interesting type of cereal that actually looked and tasted like cookies, as far as I knew.
They look like chocolate chip cookies, taste like them too, but it's a breakfast cereal!
And the efforts would always have this wolf trying to get a pack from the kids, without much success.
just missed that cookie!
Even though he never got a box of cereal, you can never blame him for trying.
Cookie crisp! Next time it's mine!
Everyone loves the Tooth Fairies. Now the Magic Tooth Fairy game brings that magic to life.
Oh yes, the Magic Tooth Fairy game. The only game where losing teeth can be fun. Even though you're not actually losing a real tooth, it's just a fake tooth.
Lose a tooth. Put it under the pillow. And the magic bed turns it into gold.
Can you imagine how cool or possibly violent this game would be if the money was actually real? The magic bed turns it into gold. Just imagine a smackdown going down whenever they win a coin.
The Magic Tooth Fairy game makes losing teeth fun.
Hey look, it's Matt Lucas from Little Britain.
Come for a spin with me and discover
how will you use your
one. If you're watching in black and white, is the yellow bit false?
Two, find a star and lick it off.
Well actually, this was back before Little Britain was on the bench. When Matt Lucas used to advertise stuff. And I'd actually forgotten that he advertised cream eggs at the time.
Three, is it with the light off? I've seen the future.
And it's egg shape!
No, no.
How will you eat yours?
Oh yes, good old VCI videos. What good fun will they have for us today?
VCI presents some of the most popular children's characters available to buy on video.
Figures they start with Thomas the Tank Engine. That little locomotive. It's like when Castle Vision started off with Tugs.
All aboard, if you please, for Britt Allcroft's Thomas the Tank Engine and Friends. Hold tight, everyone, and take a ride on your favourite railway line.
Here he comes!
With Thomas the Tank Engine and all his wonderful friends.
My branch line is the pride of the line.
No engines ever felt prouder than those on the Fat Controller's Railway.
Well, it only makes sense to start off your video premise with Thomas the Tank Engine. I mean, after all, he was voted the number one British television show for kids by WatchMojo.com.
And now you can sing along with Thomas too. Your favourite story collection, story and song collection, and the biggest ever Christmas collection. Also available, Thomas the Tank Engine and Friends Playtime, and the brand new release, Chases, Races and Runaways. 18 episodes of mischief and mishaps. You never know what the animals
want. Well, it's no Cosgrove Hall animation style.
The rascally rats are always there to get up to some sort of mischief or another. So it's bound to be loads of fun.
One by one and say hello to the morning sun. Work to do and jobs to be done, not always fun.
Hey! Oh yeah, how the hell can anyone forget City? That lovable teddy bear with his dim-witted sausage-brained dog, his girlfriend Panda, and the little scamp cousin Scampy.
Not always on the right side of the law.
The law with the terrible horn. You wait and see.
Elastic Tricks and Speedy Sweep. Also available and packed with festive fun, My Bumper Christmas Sooty. Max and Mim invite you to a Christmas teddy bear sing-song.
Jeez, Thomas the Tank Engine had more facial expression than these two bears.
Join in and sing along to all your festive favourites. As well as classic party tunes. This fun-packed video will provide hours of endless fun, well into the new year.
Oh look, we got some adventures with the world's ugliest ragdolls.
And easy to learn in one of four programs exclusively made for video, never to be seen on TV. Fun with French, ABC, Animal Adventures and Counting, 1, 2 and 3.
I is the big friendly giant.
This animated movie from Cosgrove Hall was a classic. And no live-action remakes can change that.
Children's classic, the BFG.
You is in dream country.
And it was one of the many Cosgrove Hall works that David Jason was in, including Danger Mouse, Wind in the Willows, and Count Dracula. And this one was definitely another one of their gems.
Masses of titles, hours of fun, available now.
we've taken everything you love about Thomas's adventures and put them in our new miniature playset.
How many Thomas fans out there remember the Thomas Miniatures collection? It was a collection of mini playsets with mini trains that you could have your own adventures with. And the one I had was the one they were advertising here. A big Sodor layout with Thomas and Percy and Bulstrode.
Where Thomas pops his way to the seaside, Percy gets bumped off the track. Watch out, Thomas, there's danger on the line. Grumpy old Bulstrode gets a headache. And what's this? A runaway train. Oh, that was close.
Whew, that was a close shame. For a minute, I thought he was going to fall off the track.
And I used to create my own adventures with these little playsets, and had a lot of fun with them too. And it's a real shame that they're not going to bring it back anytime soon.
Thomas the Tank Engine's miniature collection. There's a different adventure every day. Miniature railway and play cases available at your favourite store.
Speaking of forgotten stuff, how many of you remember the Cadbury Land adverts? It was where Cadbury basically wanted to make mascots for some of their famous chocolates. But the only one of these characters that actually lasted longer than the others was Buttons. Years later, she ended up getting her own individual adverts. I guess she was a fan favourite.
Gee, that would have been a laugh, wouldn't it?
Well, if you want to put it that way, kid.
The TARDIS is under...
Oh yeah, Doctor Who action figures. These things are the shit.
Slitheen, Cassandra, and Sycorax. But don't worry, the Doctor can fight them off with his sonic screwdriver.
I'm not sure if I've told you this before, folks, but when Doctor Who first came back in 2005, I wasn't really a huge fan of it. In fact, the only episodes I would actually watch all the way through were the ones for the Daleks. But thanks to David Tennant, I am now a Whovian.
Oh no! The Daleks have joined the battle!
And this was only a year before they made non-remote controlled Dalek toys.
Time to get out of here! Doctor Who action figures and playsets.
From character.
Have you seen this man?
How many of you LEGO fans out there remember LEGO Island 2 The Britster's Revenge? It was one of the funnest video games I ever played on the PC. And in my opinion, it was funner than LEGO Racers 2.
As Pepper, it's up to you to stop the Brickster. Are you ready for adventure on PC? Windows 95, 98 or Millennium Edition required.
And the pack I got for LEGO Island 2 was one that came with a keychain Brickster. And I loved every second of this game growing up.
And for those of you who haven't played the game yet, let me just say that the boss battle at the end between the Brickster is one of the easiest boss battles I've ever played in a video game.
LEGO Island 2, The Brickster's Revenge. Rated E for everyone. Each game and system sold separately. Your world, your rules.
Oh yes, the days of Jenga when it was treated as a martial arts thing in this advert. For some reason, these martial artists would play Jenga for some reason rather than just doing martial arts skills. But it does make sense, since you've got to use skill for this game.
Fingers like so. But most important... develop love like so.
I wonder if anyone's ever actually tried doing that in real life.
A fun advert for a fun game you won't be forgetting anytime soon.
Jenga!
Oh good, another McDonald's advert. What would they be advertising for the Happy Meals this time?
Impressive, isn't it?
Some busted
little handheld consoles.
One in every McDonald's Happy Meal.
I don't know about you guys, but I honestly would have preferred an actual toy rather than a handheld video game.
Ah well, if it had Sonic the Hedgehog on it, we were gonna love it anyway.
Get happy!
Well, I'm afraid that's all the time we have for today. Hope you enjoy all your fins from the 90s and early 2000s. And remember, ha ha ha! I'm Dali 44, and I'll see you next time, folks. Ha ha ha, I think I'll try that next time I play a game with someone.
They just do.
Not Ringo.
I love oranges. I don't know why I don't eat them more often. Oh, hey guys, Starlet 44 here. I need no introduction, but I got one anyway. Well, it's my 350th videoversary. So what can I do now to celebrate it in a different way compared to the other 100 videoversaries? Well, I think I'll just talk about one of the things that I love the most. Steam engines.
These lovely old engines captured the hearts of thousands of people when steam was the power source dominating our railways. The 19th century really belonged to the steam engine and the railways. During the years that steam was mastered, it developed a dedicated following that's still here today. Although replaced by diesel locomotives, many of these marvellous machines have been brought back to working life by the enthusiasm of hundreds of steam lovers. Now the memories can flood back for those born in the era, while the young ones can discover a new interest. Steam trains also create a wonderful activity for thousands of tourists, who are able to use a fascinating form of transport to see the countryside.
So sit back, relax, get out a bowl of oranges, and enjoy my tribute to the Beer Heights Light Railway at Peckham Rath.
For those of you who may not know, Peckham Rath is a little narrow gauge railway and beer in Devon, where thousands of tourists from all over the world can visit to ride on a steam train and a diesel train. And it was one of the many railway places I visited as a kid and is still visiting today. On Monday the 14th of July 1975, the Beer Heights Light Railway officially opened in Peckham. And a plant was planted by Wilbert Audrey's wife to commemorate the official opening of the railway.
As a steam train lover, I've watched many railway documentaries and been to many heritage railways, including some heritage railways in Britain, narrow gauge railways in Wales, Snowdon Mountain, and the narrow gauge railway in Peckham. Peckham being my favourite, of course.
The railway has many different steam locomotives, including Linda, Thomas II, Mr. P, Dickie, and many others. And two diesel engines, Jimmy and Ben. These lovely little engines spend their daily lives carrying people around their little railway, under bridges, through tunnels, and overlooking the beautiful sea of beer. Like any other railway, this one has to keep their little engines fresh and work in order, which is what the little workshop is used for. and you could go past it on the train, so you could see all the engines lined up in the sheds. And if you're lucky, you may be able to see the people working on the engines, giving them their routine maintenance.
This railway has loads of steam locomotives and only two diesel engines, which makes sense seeing as how they only use the diesel engines for the last trains of the day. Which really makes sense since the children love steam engines a lot more since they look more interesting.
At the starting point, much Natter Station, there is a water tower for the engines to have a drink. At the end of every journey, the trains have to change tracks and take the coaches to the departure platform. And then go around on the turntable. And try to watch this clip without getting this certain piece of music in your head. Like all railway journeys, the journey of this railway starts at the departure platform at Much Natter Station, where your ticket would be hole punched by the conductor, and you would be able to take your seats in the little coaches. And they provide open air coaches and coaches with roofs, so you could take shelter from the rain if there ever is rain. Or if it's a lovely sunny day, you could choose the open head coaches, where you could get a nice ray of sunshine, especially on a lovely day such as this. this beautiful little railway seems to be an essential and iconic part of Bin, and all who ride the train seem to agree with it. Railway are very helpful and friendly too. As you see here where the train stops just outside the tunnel because the driver has noticed the lost hat on the track. So being the kind, generous person as he is, he picks up the hat and takes it back on the train with him to take to the station's lost and found. Once it makes its full journey around the Bear Heights Light Railway, the train comes back into Much Natter Station, where the journey ends. But although the train journey may be at an end, the fun at Pekarama is not. And it's not just train rides that makes Pekarama a popular place in Beer Endeavour. There's a whole range of things to do there. And a lot of entertainment for the kids. Once you've finished your train journey, you can walk around the Pekarama Gardens, where you can see so many lovely plants that have been planted there by many people, including Mrs. W. Audrey and Christopher Audrey, who used to visit Pekarama to tell Thomas the Tank Engine stories to the children who visit it. But as far as I know, he doesn't do that anymore, which is really a shame because he did used to visit the railway a lot, including his mother, Mrs. Audrey.
Sadly though, I've missed all of Christopher Audrey's story readings at Pekarama. But it is nice to know that the Audrey family did go there every once in a while. And they got some plaques from the gardens to prove it.
Pekarama also has cafes and a little shop where you could buy tea and cake. Or if you want to cool down on a hot sunny day, you could buy yourself an ice cream. At the top of Pekarama, there's a little playground for the children to play in once they've had a ride on the train. And there's also the crazy golf course with a railway theme, where if you're a golf lover or learning to play golf, you can have some fun on the golf course.
I used to play crazy golf in Pekarama a lot when I was young. I would tend to whack the ball as hard as I can. I was young and foolish.
Even after you've visited the Pekarama Gardens, the excitement doesn't stop there. For you can have a walk on the old station platform and have a meal in the Pullman dining car.
I find it really amazing how they were able to take a Pullman coach from the old days and convert it into a restaurant. That's a really clever idea, as well as being a mascot in the entrance of the Pekarama Railway.
But that's not all Pekarama has to offer. There's also a modern railway exhibition near the gift shop where you can see layouts for several railways in different cities and countries. There's a set for British Railways, a set devoted to Thomas the Tank Engine and his friends, sets from Welsh Narrow Gauge Railways, and even sets from American Railways. There's even a little bay where you can control certain trains, a goods train, a steam train, and an express train. And just by paying 10p a coin, you can operate your own train for a certain amount of time. And after you exit the modern railway exhibition, you'll enter the gift shop, where you could buy several items relating to railways. Whether it be Batchman model railways, Hornby model railways, railway-related books and DVDs, and of course Thomas the Tank Engine merchandise, including Take and Play, Wooden Railway, and the Railway Series books. Pekarama also has a range of special activities and events that go on every year, including visitor engines helping out on the big busy summer days at the railway. And for 2 years on the trot, they've had a Doctor Who Day, where various actors from the Doctor Who, old and new, come to visit the railway to do Q&As and sign autographs. On their first Doctor Who Day, I got to meet the Sith Doctor himself, Colin Baker. Then on the second year, I got to meet Nicholas Briggs, the voice of the Daleks, for the second time. And just to add more of the humour, I got to ride on a train with a Cyberman. Funny, isn't it? But that's just one of the many activities and events that go on in Pekarama.
Pekarama is one of the best places to go if you love steam trains. And I hope that by now, after watching this video, that you're very keen to go to Pekarama and see what they have to offer.
Because if you're a steam engine lover, then you'll want to come back again and again once you've gone. And here you can enjoy at first hand the enjoyment of a nostalgic steam train ride, as these trains are operating for just that purpose. The Beerheit's Light Railway is definitely a great tribute to the steam age that will never die, and many people can enjoy it for years to come. Thanks to Pekarama and the support of many of the volunteers and full-time staff at the private railways and museums, steam locomotives work on into the 21st century and beyond. There are many railways in Great Britain, whether it be standard gauge or narrow gauge. But Pekarama is definitely a great place to visit in Devon, especially if you want to see steam engines and ride on them. And because of railways like this, that the glorious days of the steam engine lives on for many years to come. Well, I hope you've all enjoyed my 350th videoversary talking about a childhood memory that's going to live on for many years to come. And look out for more videos in the future. But until then, this is Starlet 44 saying cheerio.
Not Ringo.
Hey guys, Starlet 44 here. I need no introduction, but I got one anyway. And welcome to another installment of The Villain Files. Since it's the month of Halloween, I thought it'd be suitable to have this villain's file on a ghost. And not just any ghost, but the leader of the most famous ghosts in the Mario Bros. Franchise. This is King Boo. King Boo is the leader of the Boos and the main antagonist of the Luigi's Mansion series, and is the archenemy of Luigi. He is also an ally of Bowser, who has aided him in his various schemes. Before the events of Luigi's Mansion, Professor Egad captured Boolossus. Using a device called Ghost Portraitificationizer, Egad trapped Boolossus in a portrait and hung him in his gallery inside his lab in the Boo Woods. This angered King Boo, so he devised a plan to rescue Boolossus. King Boo and his forces attacked the laboratory, the Boos reversed the settings on the portraitificationizer and released Boolossus. King Boo then ordered that all the ghosts that Egad had captured should be released as well. After releasing all the portrait ghosts, King Boo created a huge mansion and placed it next to the professor's lab. King Boo, his Boo minions, and the recently freed portrait ghosts decided to inhabit the mansion. With a huge mansion and an army of ghosts, King Boo decided to exact revenge upon Mario and Luigi by capturing them. Hoping to capture Luigi, King Boo sends him a letter. The message states that Luigi has won a mansion in a contest and provides the location of the prize. Luigi asks his brother Mario to investigate the mansion and says he will arrive shortly thereafter. Mario and Toad travel to the mansion, but right after Mario enters, he is instantly overwhelmed by King Boo's forces and captured. King Boo then imprisons him in a portrait, similar to how Boolossus was imprisoned. Mario is placed in the secret altar of the basement of the mansion. With Mario captured, King Boo is ready to capture Luigi. While waiting for Luigi, King Boo and his Boo minions wait behind a secret door in the floor of the storage room. When Luigi enters the room and reveals the secret door, the Boos spring out from the floor. However, the Boos, including King Boo, stop their surprise attack when they notice the Poltergeist 3000 on Luigi's back. Luigi had been given the Poltergeist 3000 by E. Gant so he could recapture the portrait ghosts and save his brother. The Poltergeist 3000 is one of the few things Kim Boo fears, and he and the other Boos scatter and hide in the mansion. Kim Boo travels to the secret altar in the mansion's basement. A special key that Vincent van Gogh holds unlocks the path to the secret altar. However, he is locked in the artist's studio on the third floor of the mansion. After capturing him and retrieving the key, Luigi discovers that he still cannot enter the secret altar. If Luigi attempts to enter the secret altar without catching a certain number of Boos, Kim Boo blows Luigi into the foyer, the entrance of the mansion. Since Kim Boo's power is related to the number of Boos in the mansion, Luigi can weaken him by capturing the Boos hidden in various rooms. After Luigi captures at least 40 of the mansion's 50 Boos, Kim Boo loses his ability to blow Luigi from the secret altar. Once Kim Boo is weakened, Luigi enters Kim Boo's secret altar. Upon entering the altar, Luigi notices Kim Boo staring at Mario in the painting. Kim Boo turns around to face Luigi and states his desire to add a Luigi painting to his collection. After this, Kim Boo flies into the Mario painting hanging on the wall. The picture of Mario transforms into Bowser. Then the new Bowser painting inhales Luigi into the canvas, transporting Luigi into an area that resembles the mansion's roof. Luigi then confronts Bowser. In reality, this is a suit Bowser that Kim Boo controls from inside and uses as a shield. Kim Boo uses this Bowser suit to attack Luigi, shooting flames at him, and even attempting to inhale him into its mouth. The suit also has the ability to create three large spike bombs and toss them at Luigi, which then explode. Luigi uses his Poltergeist 3000 to grab one of the spiked explosives and release it into the Bowser suit's mouth. This attack blasts the head off of the Bowser suit, causing Kim Boo to exit the shield and expose himself to the Poltergeist 3000. Luigi begins to deplete the ghost's 500 hit points. Meanwhile, the suit's head hovers around the area, shooting ice blasts at Luigi, which will freeze him briefly. Kim Boo, after a while, flies back into the dormant Bowser body and the head reattaches itself, resuming the fight. Luigi repeats the process, slowly weakening Kim Boo, but after Kim Boo's life fails below 200 MP, the head of the suit reattaches backwards whenever he returns to the Bowser body. The suit soon corrects its head and resumes the fight. Eventually, Luigi manages to completely drain Kim Boo of his energy and capture him inside the Poltergeist 3000. After the battle, Luigi receives Kim Boo's crown, worth 5,000 grand, and adds it to his treasure collection. Upon returning to the mansion, Luigi quickly travels to Professor Egad's lab. Luigi connects the Poltergeist to the Professor's portificationizer, dumping its contents into the machine. Oddly, not only does the spirit of Kim Boo appear in the machine, but also the fake Bowser. With Kim Boo captured, Professor Egad hangs his new portrait in an empty room of his gallery.
Even though Kim Boo was defeated and trapped in a portrait at the end of Luigi's Mansion, he made a number of appearances in the games that followed up after this.
A different Kim Boo is the leader of the Boos on Isle Delfino and appears as the boss in Serena Beach, the sip rod of Super Mario Sunshine. He is apparently made out of goop, as could be seen during his defeat, meaning that Bowser Jr. might have drawn him. This game also has notes that he dislikes spicy food, which serves as the key to defeat him. Like the description says, I consider him to be a very different Kim Boo from the one in Luigi's Mansion because of his appearance. Kim Boo also appears in the Super Mario 64 remake, Super Mario 64 DS. As the boss who locked Luigi away, he captures a part of Princess Peach's castle. However, in the English translation of the game, Kim Boo is incorrectly called Big Boo, even though he is clearly different from the Big Boo in Big Boo's Haunt. Regardless, Kim Boo aids Bowser in his conquest of Peach's castle by capturing Luigi and imprisoning him in Big Boo's Haunt. Specifically, Luigi is imprisoned behind a painting of himself inside the haunted mansion. Mario heads to the Big Boo battle level to save Luigi. Upon entering the level, he is greeted by Kim Boo. From there, he must listen to Kim Boo's cackle and enter the door where it is loudest. Eventually, Mario reaches the end and fights Kim Boo to free Luigi. To defeat Kim Boo, Mario has to follow Kim Boo's movements in the area's mirror and stomp him when he comes close enough. Ultimately, Mario saves his brother from Kim Boo, and together, with Yoshi and Waluigi, once he is saved, they defeat Bowser and save Princess Peach. Kimbu also aids Bowser in Super Princess Peach when Bowser has captured the Mario Brothers and Peach has to save them. But I honestly never really played that game, so I don't know the full story of it, so moving on. Outside of these main games, Kimbu has also appeared in the Mario Kart games from Mario Kart Double Dash and in some of the Mario Party games. And it's kind of funny how he would be invited to those events, even though he's done so many nasty things to the Mario Brothers. But then again, they still invite Bowser to these sporting events and kart racing, so question withdrawn.
Despite all these cameos and various other versions of him showing up, it would take 11 or 12 years, depending on what region you're from, for him to make an official return in the next Luigi's Mansion game.
Kimbu makes his official comeback in the Nintendo 3DS game Luigi's Mansion Dark Moon, once again as the main antagonist and final boss. He looks similar to his original appearance from Luigi's Mansion, but retains the full set of teeth and sped up voice he had in his appearances in the other Mario titles, and is also much larger. It is revealed later in the game that Professor Egad had sold the portrait of Kimbu from Luigi's Mansion at a car boot sale, which is how the Kin escaped. Kimbu shatters the Dark Moon into 6 pieces with a bolt of energy from his crown, which contained a power enchanted gem. This turns the once friendly ghosts of Evershade Valley hostile and mischievous, as well as spalling the Dark Moon's pieces to each mansion in the valley, which Luigi has to recover. Towards the end of the game, it is revealed that he has captured Mario like he did in the last game. After Luigi gets the last Dark Moon piece and returns to the bunker, he captures Luigi and pulls him back into the paranormal dimension. He reveals to Luigi he escaped from the painting and broke the Dark Moon, causing the ghost to become under his control. He intends to use the ghosts as an army to conquer the world, of course. He also plans to put Luigi and Egad into paintings as well for revenge. He then engages into battle with Luigi, but he fails and is sucked into the poltergeist once again.
Alongside Bowser, Kimbu continues to be one of the most recognisable villains in the Super Mario Bros. Franchise, and is still popular to this day.
Kimbu's appearance is very different from all the other Boos, as you will see in most of the games. In the Luigi's Mansion series, he has red eyes, a crown with a jewel on it, and a blue mouth, while in the other games he retains the look of the other Boos and has a very different crown, but still keeps that creepy high cackle of his. All in all, Kimbu is one of the best antagonists of the Mario Bros. Franchise, and I hope that they'll do more Luigi's Mansion games very soon, and that they'll get a spotlight in other games in the Mario franchise as well.
And that's everything I know about Kimbu, archenemy of Luigi. Keep looking out for more villain fires in the future. I'm Dali44, and I'm off to play Luigi's Mansion.
Ringo.
For those of you who don't know, Ken Barry, the voice of Postman Pat, died this year. So I'm here to pay tribute to him in the best way I know how, to talk about the show Postman Pat, written by John Cunliffe, the original creator, writer and presenter of Rosie and Jim, and directed by Ivor Woods, who'd worked on other famous shows such as The Magic Roundabout, The Herbs, The Wombles, and many others. It was about the life adventures of the friendly postman in the village of Greendale.
It didn't do anything other children's television shows like Power Rangers, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and many others did where it was heroes and villains. It focused on everyday life of a friendly postman in the British countryside.
It ran for 7 series of 167 episodes, got a spin-off show and a big screen movie, and left a huge impact on many people who watched it. But which episodes are the best? Which ones are the funniest, most influential, and all around just the most entertaining of all time?
Well, many people have their own personal favourite episodes, Darling 44. What are your favourite episodes?
Well, today we're going to have a look at my top 10 favourite episodes from Postman Pat Sue. So, sit back and enjoy my top 10 favourite Postman Pat episodes.
Number 10. Postman Pat's Difficult Day. Pat's alarm clock fails to wake him up and he runs late on his rounds and gets into all sorts of scrapes along the way. Like nearly forgetting his hat on his rounds, tripping over and his hat ending up on Jess, getting into a muddle with Ted Glenn's messy parcel of spare parts like cogs and screws and nuts and bolts and what have you, and even getting into a scrape with Alf Thompson's ladder, injuring his leg, having to have the post delivered by Sam Warden instead. This episode is definitely one of the funniest ones I've seen, because it shows what might happen if Postman Pat ever ran late on his rounds. And the Postman Jess fin still cracks me up to this day.
What are you playing at, Jess? Do you think you're Postman Jess or something?
Postman Jess!
Pat doesn't have to solve any problems or anything like that in this one. It's just an episode showing what might happen if our friendly postman ever ran late on his rounds and ever had a bad day.
Oops! Hey, Hope, what are you doing? Sorry, Alf. Hang on. Hold it steady! Not that way, the other way. I said the other way! Oh! Ouch!
Number 9. Postman Pat's Foggy Day. There is a thick fog in Greendale. Pat stops at the post office to have a cup of tea and a biscuit. But when the post finally arrives and Pat goes back on his round, he ends up getting lost and feels silly when he thinks the scarecrow is Ted and gives him a letter. But the main highlight of this episode is when Jess goes missing and Pat goes out to find him in the fog. And when he eventually finds Jess, they end up getting lost in the fog as well. So it's up to Reverend Timms and Miss Hubbard to send them back to the church. This is one of the few episodes of the show that takes place really early morning before it gets really light and there's huge fog about. And the bit with Pat thinking that the scarecrow is Ted still cracks me up to this day.
Pat walked up very quietly so as not to disturb the rabbits and touched Ted on the shoulder. Ted didn't move. Pat put the letter in Ted's pocket. He still didn't move. Pat gave him a nudge. Oh, it was a scarecrow.
This reminds me of the time Sweet Miss took a parrot for a robin. He's a real sausage brain.
Indeed he is, Sue.
And I think we've all had this experience. When we're trying to drive through a thick fog and we get lost and can't see the way through and we have to ask people for directions, all that sort of thing. It's just Pat being put in a real life situation on a really foggy day. And it's still entertaining to this day forward.
Pat did feel silly. He was glad no one saw him.
Number 8. Postman Pat's Finding Day. Pat calls to the post office, and today most of the post is for Katie and Tom Pottish because it's their birthday. But Katie feels really sad today because she's lost her favourite doll, Sarah Ann. So Pat goes on a mission to find her while still going on his rounds. He looks in the church and finds a glove belonging to Dorothy Thompson. He goes to Dorothy Thompson's house and finds Ted Glenn's penknife. He goes to Ted Glenn's workshop to have a look but finds Miss Hubbard's watch. Then he goes to Miss Hubbard's house where Sam's mobile shop is and eventually finds Sarah Ann hiding behind the chocolates in Sam's van.
Enjoying yourself, Pat.
I once lost my favourite teddy bear.
Oh, dear, did you ever find it in the end, Sue?
Sooty was my lost teddy bear.
Oh, makes sense.
This was the first ever episode of Postman Pat that aired, and it was also the first time we saw just how helpful and friendly Pat was. Going out of his way to look for a lost doll while still going on his rounds. It just makes him a really likeable character from this first episode to the rest of the series. And I think all postmen in real life should be like this. So whether postmen in real life will ever be as helpful as him, this episode started the whole phenomenon of Postman Pat.
Found anything? Oh! Yes, a bump on the head.
Number 7. Person of Pat's Rainy Day. It was a heavy rainy day in Greendale. Even the letters are wet when Pat goes to the post office to collect them. And once he goes on his rounds, the rain stops, but he sees the effects of the rain, like Peter Fogg getting his tractor stuck in the mud and having to get a new tractor to pull the old one out, the children having fun with the puddles in the playground, and a landslide in the road.
Blooming rain. It makes no end of work.
I love rainy days. It's so much fun splashing in puddles.
The real excitement of this episode comes when Pat comes to the roadblock, when Alf Thompson tries to get through it on his tractor but fails, then his son Bill sends an airplane with a message to Greendale Farm to get help, and then finally Peter Fogg comes in with his new tractor with a bulldozer blade to get rid of the blockage. Even though it doesn't exactly rain throughout the whole episode, it's just an interesting look at what Postman Pat's rounds would be like after or during a rainy day. And the events here are so funny that you'll be entertained all the way through. It's a great episode with bad weather that you're going to enjoy to this day.
It's nice to see someone enjoying the rain.
Number 6. Postman Pat and the Hole in the Road. Mr. Pringle has been teaching the children about volcanoes and earthquakes. Then the next day, Pat discovers a little hole in the road that's been blocked by P.C. Selby. But the ridiculous thing about it is it is such a small pothole that it's just so ridiculous to make such a huge fuss over.
Is this what all the fuss is about? It doesn't look much to me. I've seen bigger. A baby one.
Matthew once punched a tire in the hole in the road. He had to call the AA.
Oh, how did that go?
Badly, he had no idea Sooty and Sweeper got a part-time job with the AA at the time.
And it was my introduction to Arthur Selby, probably one of the funniest policemen that's ever existed.
Now then, what's going on there? Look out, here comes trouble. Come on, legs. You know this road's closed. You must have seen the signs. I'll have to take your names and addresses.
Don't be daft, Arthur. You've known us ever since we were in short trousers.
Never mind that. We have to do it proper. Now then, how do you spell proceeding? You haven't got a pencil sharpener on you by any chance?
Nothing extremely exciting really happens in this episode, but it's an interesting look at what a pothole situation might be like in Greendale. And it's especially hilarious how Arthur takes such a tiny pothole so seriously. It's an entertaining episode with entertaining characters and an entertaining police officer, and the ending is so funny that you'll be laughing on the floor.
I think there are two E's in proceeding, but is it a C or an S?
Number 5. Postman Pat takes a message. It has been wild and windy in Greendale, and the telephone lines are down. And the Reverend Timms is off to see his sister in London and is about to catch a train. But when Pat arrives at the post office, they get a phone call asking the postman to send a message to the Reverend Timms saying that she'll be arriving in Greendale. So Pat has to drive all the way through the village to find the Reverend Timms and tell him before he catches the train. And the ways he tries to get to him are so hilarious. First he tries to drive through the fields in his van, but gets blocked with a trailer. Then he walks up to Miss Hubbard's house and borrows her bicycle to get to Ted Glenn's workshop. And he crashes the bike into Ted's workshop and has to go on roller skates the rest of the way. It's just hilarious to see Pat going outside his van for a while and the many attempts he'll get through to get to the Reverend Timms before he catches the train. And I just can't get enough of seeing Pat in those roller skates.
How do you stop? Whoa!
Whoa. And who the hell could ever forget Pat driving like a lunatic through the village?
I haven't seen driving as fast as that since Sooty challenged a stick to a race.
Oh, Sooty challenged a stick to a race once, did he? And who was the winner in the end?
Sooty won by a photo finish.
Oh, I always thought the stick would win in a race against Sooty.
Not to mention that nice little song about Jess the cat.
Jess is his cat. Jess is his cat. Jess is his cat. And it's always been like that. And it's always been like that. Always been like that. Always been like that.
It's another funny episode where Pat has a race against time to stop the vicar from making a mistake.
Oh dear, I couldn't do this every day.
Number 4. Postman Pat and the Big Surprise. Pat does some gardening before work. When he tries to remove a weed, he sprains his back and Sarah calls Dr. Gilbertson in.
My back. Oh, it does not hurt.
Here, let me straighten you up.
Ow! Ow! Oh, stop! It's worse like that!
Good night, everybody!
That's what happens when you bend your back too much. The same thing happened to Richard the last time he tried to clean the gutter.
Pat needs to spend a day in bed, so Sarah offers to take the post instead. Everyone is surprised to see Sarah delivering the post instead of Pat. Sarah has also forgotten something. This is definitely one of the interesting episodes where we see Pat actually not be able to take the post out for a change. And it was nice to have his wife Sarah have the spotlight for a change as well. Also, it's kind of funny how she wears that hat in comparison to how big her hair is. I mean, that hat doesn't even fit on her, for crying out loud. It's a very interesting episode with an interesting change of postman, or lady in this case, and it still entertains me to this day. Number 3. Letters on ice and Postman Pat goes sledging.
What? Isn't that cheating, Dolly 44? Putting two episodes into one number?
Well, let me explain.
I like these episodes so much that I just couldn't have them separate. Plus, if I did, it would make this the top 11 list. In Letters on Ice, Postman Pat tries to deliver his letters to other people but can't get through a snowblock, so he has to skate across the ice with a pair of skates that Ted Glenn lends him. It's quite interesting to see Postman Pat go ice skating for a change rather than walking. And it's very funny to see him almost losing his balance every time.
Special ice delivery today.
And in Postman Pat Goes Sledging, Peter Fogg is clearing the roads of snow, but there's just one bit of snow on the road that's so heavy that Peter Fogg had to turn back. Which leaves Pat no choice but to go on a sledge with Alf Thompson to deliver George Lancasters and stuff to him. And feed his sheep as well. And the journey back on the sledge is the most hilarious part in the episode.
We'll have a fast ride downhill. Give us a push. Hold on. Here we go. Hold on, Pat. Help. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, dear. You all right, Pat?
All in one piece, I think.
Well, I don't like to blow my own trumpet, but I'm a champion snowball fighter.
So even though these are two separate episodes, I had to put them on the list as one because they're both as entertaining as each other. And they're both snow-based episodes. And those two rarely fail to make me laugh.
This snow can't last forever.
Number 2. Postman Pat and the Magpie Hen. It's such a lovely day and Pat's getting on so well with his round that he stops for a picnic lunch near Thompson Ground. But Mrs. Thompson's hens have other ideas. Some steal Pat's sandwiches, and another one steals Pat's keys and puts them in his nest. So Pat has to go up there with a ladder to get his keys back. And while he does that, he finds loads of other shiny objects, almost like it was a magpie's nest.
Deary me, the little devil. She must think she's a magpie or some such.
This is the funniest thing I've ever seen!
I find this one super hilarious because you wouldn't expect to see a hen stealing shiny objects, since that's what magpies are believed to do. But it's just so hilarious to see those hens stealing his sandwiches and his keys, especially how that hen stares at Pat's sandwiches for a few seconds before making its move. This one almost made it into number 1 on this list, but there's just one episode that was just so hilarious and just had to be on the list. But this one deserves the number 2 spot because it never fails to make me laugh.
Just fancy, a magpie hen. Who ever heard of such a thing?
And my number 1 Postman Pat episode is... The Sheep in the Clover Field. It's a cloudy morning in Greendale, but the sun brightens up and Pat is having a late day after his van gets stuck in the mud. After Peter Fogg gets him out of his tractor, Pat carries on with his rounds, only to be stopped by Ted Glenn, asking for help to get the sheep back in their own field after they escape in the clover field.
Some fool's left a gate open. I bet it's those campers. The sheep have got into the clover field. It'll kill them if they eat too much.
Oh, I love sheep. They're so woolly and cuddly and so friendly.
Indeed they are, Sue. Indeed they are.
This is the first time I've ever seen Pat not actually do his rounds because he was delayed by other things, like getting stuck in the mud before collecting the letters, helping Ted Glenn round up sheep, dodging a ball.
What's that funny noise? Hey, up! It's that ball! Run! Oh! Hey, wait for me!
Fetching the doctor after Ted sprains his ankle, and then taking Ted back home afterwards. Magpie Hen almost made it to number one on the list, but I felt that Sheep in the Clover Field was just funnier than Magpie Hen, for those reasons I've listed. And I find it funny how the campers were to blame for the sheep escape in their own field, since the campers tend to leave the gate open. And this is one of those things that actually does happen in real life. People go for a walk in the country or camping. They go through fields and they forget to shut the gate when they've gone through it. This is something that happens in everyday country life, and this episode exploits it. With many delays and sheep and bulls and doctors, this episode I felt deserved the number one spot on my list.
We've left a gate open now. We're as bad as the campers.
That's a lovely list you had, Dalek 44. Thank you very much for looking after me today. I feel so much better now.
Anytime, Sue. Well, it is a shame that Ken Barry is gone now. But like all the other actors I've made tributes to, his legacy will live on forever. And Postman Pat is a prime example of his legacy and why no one will ever forget him.
It's a real shame that Ken Barry has passed away this year, but his legacy will live on in this show. In the classic episodes, anyway. And with Ken Barry's voice, Ivor Woods directing and John Cunliffe's writing, Postman Pat will always be one of the best children's TV shows of my childhood, and any other people's childhood.
Until next time, this is Dalek 44 and Sue saying,
bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Can I give you a kiss, Dalek 44?
Yeah, go on then.
Mwah.
Through the beautiful valley and its lovely countryside, as he sits up by the window and the views go gliding by. Jess is his cat. Jess is his cat. Jess is his cat. And it's always been like that. And it's always been like that.
Well, I don't like to blah, blah, blah.
Yes, a bump on the head.
Not Ringo.
Hey guys, Dalek 44 here. I need no introduction, but I've got one anyway. Are you all excited and ready for Christmas yet? I know I am.
Now, I've talked about quite a few Christmas specials in the past with my top 12 Christmas specials list, some of the Christmas reviews I've done, and Thomas Sembo as well. But you may be asking, what can I review today that's Christmas related? Well, how about a Christmas Carol adaptation? Yeah, you know, the classic Charles Dickens books that gets adapted too many times to count.
But you may be asking yourselves, which Christmas Carol adaptation am I going to review today? No, not this one. It's the one starring Mickey Mouse. Well, you've asked me what my opinions are on this special, and now here they are for all to be seen. Mickey's Christmas Carol, the 1983 American animated adaptation of the classic tale produced by Walt Disney Productions. Even before December this year, I've had loads of people requesting that I review Mickey's Christmas Carol, even though I talked about it a little bit in Mickey's Magical Christmas Snow Day at the House of Mouse. So what do I think of this adaptation of a Christmas Carol? Well, let's have a look. Well, for like the two of you out there who don't know the story by now, Ebenezer Scrooge, played by Scrooge McDuck, is a surly moneylender who does not share the merriment of Christmas and cares not for the poor. But that all changes one night when the ghost of his partner Jacob Marley, played by Goofy, warns him about the wicked future that awaits for him in the afterlife, and soon gets visited by three spirits played by Jiminy Cricket, Willy the Giant, and Pegleg Pete. After all that, Scrooge changes his ways and becomes a better man in the future. So, what are my thoughts on the second ever adaptation of A Christmas Carol I ever saw? It's one of the best adaptions I've ever seen to this day. This was the second Christmas Carol adaptation I've ever seen, with the first ever one being The Muppet Christmas Carol. But I find this one to be one of the best Christmas Carol adaptations I've ever seen. For one thing, you've got Scrooge McDuck played by the late Alan Young as Ebenezer Scrooge. How much more fitting can you get? And I find this version of Scrooge to be better than the Scrooge from Muppet Christmas Carol. More because he shows a lot more emotion with his performance. Like when he's the miser, you really feel how misery he is. And when he gets upset, you really feel how upset he is. And when he's excited, you really feel his excitement. And we got the late Wilaine Allwhite voicing Mickey Mouse as Bob Cratchit. And he plays the part really well, even though he doesn't really get that much screen time. Even though his name's in the title of the special. But it never really bothered me as much as it did Siskel and Ebert, because the story is really about Ebenezer, not about Bob. And having Donald Duck as the nephew of Scrooge was a very interesting choice, and also understandable since they're uncle and nephew in real life. And I think it's also one of the few times where you see Donald Duck as a calm character rather than the angry, losing his temper character that we normally see him as. It's also kind of interesting seeing Goofy play the ghost of Jacob Marley, considering the type of character he is. But it does offer for some great Goofy slapstick, as well as hearing the Goofy howl at the end of his appearance. And Minnie Mouse's Bob Cratchit's wife was a nice choice, considering that it's Mickey Mouse playing Bob Cratchit. But have you ever noticed that she doesn't get a line in this movie? I'm guessing it's probably because this was years before they casted Russell Taylor to voice her. But if they did cast her at this time, couldn't they have at least had a scene where she said stuff about Tiny Tim to Bob Cratchit, or maybe she's thanking Scrooge McDuck and all that? I mean, she had so many speaking roles before, why not just get someone to voice her until they could find Russell Taylor? But that's just a nitpick, and it doesn't come close to ruining this great adaptation. And I like the choices they made for the three spirits. Like, I like Jiminy Cricket as the Ghost of Christmas Past, because of his personality. I like Willy the Giant as the Ghost of Christmas Present, especially with this line. And Peter's the Ghost of Christmas Future was a real surprise to me. The first time I watched this as a kid, I had no idea that the ghost was going to be Pete. It was a really good reveal and payoff at the end of that. And there's so many Disney characters in this movie. We got Scrooge McDuck, Mickey Mouse, Goofy, Jiminy Cricket, Winnie the Giant, Pete, Donald Duck, Daisy Duck, Mr. Toad, Minnie Mouse, Matty, Mole, the Weasels, the Big Bad Wolf, the Three Little Pigs, Lady Cluck, March Hare, the Rabbit Children, Uncle Waldo, Grandpa Duck, Horace Horsecolor, Gus Goose, Chip and Dale, Huey, Dewey and Louie, the list goes on. I really do like how they included various other Disney characters from other films, not just Mickey Mouse related. Like, you've got characters from Ichabod and Mr. Toad, Robin Hood, the list goes on.
That was a really nice touch, putting so many animated Disney characters into one movie. This would, of course, later be upstaged with Who Framed Roger Rabbit and then Mickey's House of Mouse, but for the time, this was really awesome.
And I'm just gonna say this right now. The first time I watched Mickey's Christmas Carol when I was a kid, the moment where Pete reveals himself as the Ghost of Christmas Future and pushes Scrooge into the grave used to scare the piss out of me. But not to the point where I would never stop watching this special again.
And I'm trying to think of what else I can say about this movie that pretty much everybody else hasn't already. Everybody's seen it and everybody loves it. In fact, they more than love it, they go crazy for it. And I can understand why people go crazy for it. I mean, it stars Mickey Mouse and Scrooge McDuck in the role he was born to play.
It's almost to God amazing how they were able to fit the whole story into a half-hour cartoon. And some people might argue that it might have worked better as a full-length feature film. But I personally think it works fine as a half-hour cartoon, because they managed to fit the whole story into a half an hour. And that's not very easy to do these days.
The animation style in this movie is basically the sketchy animation that you've seen in the various other Disney films that came before this, like 101 Dalmatians, Robin Hood, and many others. Now, some people either like or dislike this style animation, but I think it makes sense for this story because it literally looks like it comes from a storybook. And that's what The Christmas Carol was. It was a storybook. So the animation just kind of makes it look like you're literally watching a book come to life. And that's really nice animation for this special, if I say so myself.
So all in all, Mickey's Christmas Carol is one of the best Christmas Carol adaptions I've ever seen, as well as one of the best Christmas specials I've seen in general.
Mickey's Christmas Carol is definitely one of the best Christmas Carol adaptions I've ever seen. And if you haven't seen it yet, then check it out and see what you've been missing. You'll get a lot of enjoyment, heart, and Christmas cheer while watching it.
So if anybody out there loves Mickey Mouse, Christmas Carol, Mickey's Christmas Carol, and Christmas in general, then put this special on and feel the Christmas cheer and feeling that it'll give you. I'm Donald 44, and I'll see you next time, folks.